Collider Live. I just figured out it was Wednesday. Hey, everybody. How's it going on this wonderful Wednesday morning? 10 a.m. PST. How's your family? Everybody doing good here. And this is going to be a fun show. We have a lot of cool things to talk about and a really special guest coming in at 11:30. And that would be Jay Baruchel from How to Train Your Dragon 3, the director of Goon 2. Excited to talk to him. We've been wanting to talk to him for a bit now.
But I'm so excited.
I know you are. I know, Roxy.
This is your Van Damme? Is this your Van Damme?
I was trying to be cool, but I can't be cool. Yeah, I've tweeted about it. I've Instagrammed about it. I texted you about it. Because I didn't know.
I know.
I didn't know.
You learned through the notes.
I learned through the notes, and then I listened to the show from when I left. Okay. And I was,
So you wanted to get filled in yesterday. How was your experience yesterday getting done with
still
high?
I still feel so high.
Oh, yeah. What do you guys, you smoke beforehand?
Or no, on the show. The whole time.
On the show with you. So Roxy was on.
Oh, you probably know her. She's at the store all the time. Her name is Sarah
Silverman.
Tiana.
Tiana?
No.
So
Sarah James.
Yes.
I'll look it up.
So
right
Roxy
now.
Was on Getting Dug with High yesterday. That's why she left the show.
He was awesome.
Yeah,
he's
great.
The show was so fun. And
why don't you look
still,
up who that was?
So
and Josh Macuga is here as well as Mark Reilly. You just banged your face into the mic. How you doing?
As you said this morning, you said I looked disheveled. I thought I looked good. I put on a collared shirt.
You do look good. You still look disheveled, though.
I still look disheveled.
It's okay.
Cool.
It's not a slight in your outfit. Your outfit is banging, but you look like you just voted with the, you know, you should get the pin.
Josh Macuga.
Good. But I don't know what it is. You just look a little disheveled.
Cool.
It's all right.
Yeah, it's all good.
But someone who does not look disheveled, he looks like he's ready to teach calc. how you doing there, Reilly?
How to Train Your Dragon.
Yeah.
I'm with Roxy.
You excited?
I've watched both movies over the past 2 days.
I'm excited. Go ahead.
Well, here's the thing for me is Jay Baruchel is in a movie called She's Out of My League, which is shot in Pittsburgh.
Oh, that's the one.
Such an underrated movie.
I love that movie.
Underrated movie. It's like genius. They play. He works at the airport. It's such a fun movie, and it all takes place in Pittsburgh. I mean, my mom was like, "We see all these celebrities now," and I was like, "All right, Mom, take it easy." It's a great one.
Well, I'm looking forward to talking to him because the How to Train Your Dragon series I love. I didn't get a chance to see a third one yet, but I will be seeing it. Perri's going to come in because she did see it, so she'll be asking some questions about the movie itself. To have him in here at 11:30 will be really cool. What the thing I'm bummed about is
can you give me that pen real quick? Sorry,
absolutely. Whatever you need.
Sure.
Gotta get it down.
Yeah, Friday, right now, it looks like we're still working on it. Nothing confirmed yet. I mentioned it yesterday. Paige, the wrestler, which the movie is inspired for Fighting With My Family, which I saw and I loved, is supposed to come in on Friday.
You did see it?
I did.
Yeah. Who did you take to it?
I didn't have to take anyone. Ellis already had it. Did you want to see that movie?
It's just so mean.
Yeah. I'm just going to throw it out there. I still haven't seen Creed 2.
Creed 2. Yeah, but I'm going to get you a Blu-ray.
Oh.
I'm gonna get you a Blu-ray.
Cool. Well, I don't have a Blu-ray player, so you
can. It comes with a DVD.
Okay.
Yeah,
cool.
So you'll be all right.
Don't say that again. Remember the comments last time you said you didn't have a Blu-ray player?
What happened? What are the comments?
They went in on it.
So what, do you have a CD player?
I have a computer with a DVD player in it, so I play the DVDs, or I just get it on demand.
You get a Blu-ray player now for like $50.
Yeah. Well, I watch a Blu-ray like twice a year.
Right.
Maybe.
You can do digital codes, I guess, right?
Yeah,
that's fine. Look, I'll give you the digital code for Creed. Does that make you feel better? All right.
Nailed it.
All right. And thank you, Compster. What I wanted to say about Paige, which is probably one of the interviews I've wanted to do from the beginning, because we wanted it before the movie, because I wanted to talk to her about her entire career, because I've been following it. And when you see what she has done for women's wrestling, the personality in general, and I wanted to just, because she's, you see, just the kind of personality that she has, she'd be a great interview. So I was very excited. It's the one Friday. I'm not going to be here.
Where are you going?
I have just family stuff I got to do. And I can't back out at the last minute because it'll mess up my wife. So I can't do it.
I was listening to the show yesterday, and you on the show were like, we're having on Thursday the biggest guest we've had on the show yet. And in my head, I'm like, good for you, Kristian. You got her to move to Thursday. Good job. And then you announced it was Finstock, and my heart broke.
Oh, I know.
Because I was ready for you to say Paige is coming.
Yeah, no, we have Finstock and Citizen, which will be a good one. I mean, that's going to be very interesting.
They're a buffoon.
I know, because they're premiering their show. That'll come in. But I think that what I'm going to do is have Rocha do the interview, because he's seen the movie as well. And Satin needs to get an interview in there, so I'm going to try to get one afterwards. Because
I won't be on the show.
Yeah, for that.
Yeah, you can.
No, I'm not doing Satin. I'm going to have Satin do. I want them to see if they can give 5 minutes for Pro Wrestling Sheet, because I can't have them after yesterday. I can't have them both in your interview.
They're both good. not when they're together like that. It was so hard. I was really trying to listen because you know, I care about this. Yeah, but when they're in this room, they were fighting about it, and I was just like, I want to hear the actual points. Like, what do you think about
Ronda
Rousey?
Ryan wouldn't let Rocha get a word in edgewise, and Rocha was getting pissed off. No.
It was just about her, but it was frustrating to me because they were actually making good points. I was trying to understand, like, why do you? Some people think she's a heel even though she's a face, and I'm newer to this, so I was really trying to listen, and I couldn't hear.
Yeah,
fucking
I know. So that's
welcome to the office.
Well, that's why I'm going to push hard because if we're scheduled with her for like 40 minutes, then I'll say give us 30 and let Ryan have it for 10.
Yeah.
Because I can't do that again because Ryan has so much he wants to talk to her about, and I don't want the Collider Live interview to suffer for it. So we're working on it. So this happens all the time. We get an email later, or she can't make it. That's happened with many guests before in the past. So
Reilly just started laughing because he found Macuga's pun. Are you going to say it out loud?
No, because I think it's a really good segment for another show.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, here's something that I do want to announce.
Go ahead.
I want to announce this because I found this out this morning. There is going to be a new member to the Collider Live family.
I was just
going
to say.
Yeah, Mr. Cody Hall's gonna be a dad.
Oh, hey guys.
Cody Hall's gonna be a dad.
Insane.
Cody Hall is now the second adult in the office next to myself, and so now Cody will be having a child. And Cody, congratulations!
Congrats!
Thank you so much.
Very cool. And the first thing I said to you, and I'll say it again: now, young fool, only in the end. Do you understand?
The first thing I did was I read all of your guys, because last time that somebody posted about being pregnant, you guys were making a joke. And before I wrote congrats, I was like, is it?
I did the same thing because I was the one who posted that last time. Yeah.
And I said, oh no, that meme started again.
Yeah.
And then I'm like, oh no,
it's
real.
Actually real.
Yeah, it was short and sweet.
When I told Copster and Brian, they thought I was joking for like a minute and a half.
Oh, really? Did you tell them on the show?
I told them on Wangers.
Oh, that's great.
Nice.
What you need to do now, because there's three of you on the Wangers, you need to do a shot-for-shot remake of Three Men and a Baby, the opening when they are painting the wall.
Yeah. Go and watch that. Have Finstock standing in the back of the ghost child.
Yeah, the ghost child.
Oh,
yeah.
Perfect.
But Cody, so how long, obviously, because there's like rules in pregnancy.
12
weeks. You don't say anything. So you've known for quite a bit here. And so every story I've told, you've probably either been scared or heartwarmed. Which one has you been leaning on more?
Oh, I've just loved all of it so much. Thank you for warning me about everything.
I'm telling you.
I'm not nervous at all now.
You should be. I told Cody, I said, look, you're going to be begging me to come to these live events because you're going to need a hotel room to sleep once. My wife uses it against me. She's like, oh, how was it to sleep? Was it nice? When I went to New York, she's like, did you get your sleep in?
Yeah.
Like, that's why I go. I don't go for the Schmoedown. I go to sleep.
Did you have a nice sleep, she said, through clenched teeth?
Yeah, that's true. Oh, really? You're going away two nights? Let me know how that sleep is. When you come back, I'll be sleeping.
My brother and sister, sister-in-law travel all the time for work, right? And so one of them's gone, the other one's gone, and it became this, like, trade-off of who could brag about how much sleep they got on the road more. And my brother, I'm a couple weekends, he's like, hey, Ash's gone all weekend. You need to come up here. I need help. Because he has got three. And they're all a lot of energy.
Well, that's what I want to find. Cody, I want to do, like, updates here because your lady's due in, what, August?
Yeah, middle of August.
Middle of August.
So once Leo.
So once we get baby Hall here, we got to talk about kind of the updates once we hit into like September through the end of
September,
the year.
September, August.
No.
Oh, when he finally had.
Because he's going to be out for a bit.
Sure,
so
sure.
Once he's back in the office and talking about it, we got to get updates. I want to see because I'm going to be pissed off at you. I'll tell you right now, if you get one of these easy babies.
Oh, yeah.
Fuck those people.
So you're wishing for
toast.
A difficult baby
100%.
For Cody. 100%.
Apparently, I was an easy baby.
Oh,
that
yeah.
means nothing.
But my wife wasn't.
Good.
We'll see what
No, happens. I want you to go through it because here's the reason why I want him to go through it. He's also like, what are you, 26?
I'll be 27 when it's born.
Okay. That's a good start.
Well, they don't know if it's a girl or a boy yet.
You're young.
What is he supposed to call it?
The baby.
The baby?
Don't say it in front of your wife. I'll tell you
What's the chance of you naming it Josh, boy or girl?
She's going to name it Comster.
It's going to be named Emma, and it's a girl, and I can sense these.
Have you been thinking about names already?
Yeah, we've had those conversations.
Yeah, you don't tell it in the air. That's a no-no. Yeah. But 26 years old, your energy, you'll be able to deal with it. I wish I was, if my kids, the baby, how she is now, is 26, I'd be able to deal with it. A lot better.
How old were you with the first baby?
33. Yeah, 33.
That's energy.
Yeah. I'm not 33 now.
Yeah.
So I want to sleep.
God, I'm going to be screwed.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I'm going to be completely screwed.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
You better.
I know. I found that hole.
You better get at it.
Once yeah, I know. Last night when yeah. when I saw it there and I was on the phone with Julie yeah. and
you're like Alec Baldwin with a three-year-old.
Yeah, I am. That's exactly true. I'm going to be. It's like it can be that when Harry Met Sally joke when he says like, yeah, but Charlie Chaplin was too old to pick him up.
Right.
I'm going to be like, you get it.
Yeah,
you
who's the real old actor that's got like a he's got like a 6-year-old or
Liam Neeson, right?
No, it's not Liam
Jack
Neeson.
Jack Nicholson, maybe.
No, that's somebody
Josh.
Like
Josh. Josh.
Yeah, I don't remember who it is. It's somebody who's got like a really young kid.
My dad's really good buddy got remarried later in life and had his first child because his first marriage didn't have a child. He had his first child at 66.
That's what I mean. Yeah, that's tough on the
don't
kid.
Don't tell me that. I keep getting so nervous. My dad's gonna knock up his young ass girlfriend.
How old's your?
My dad's 61. And? She's 24. And wow. It's just so,
oh, look at Papa. It's Papa Striar.
I keep telling him like you're wrapping it up.
He's like, why should I?
Well, he lived that rock star life for so long. I'm like, oh fuck. Right. Like, it's just.
So you're gonna be taking care of the kid, basically.
It kind of does feel inevitable.
Right.
And my siblings and I talk about it all the time. Like, that's gonna be real weird.
How's the relationship with the siblings these days? Because this is a continuation from one on one.
My siblings.
Yeah.
Good. Great. Good. Yeah. They're my best friends now.
Awesome. I love it.
Took a long
time.
I know.
You should go back and revisit that interview if you haven't done it.
Really cool. I really want people to go revisit it because for a little bit I got some slack here. Like I got a little bit of a break because people were like, oh, we understand who she is
now.
We like
shit
her
again?
Now. Yeah, the shit. Although one of the shit I got yesterday was so deserved and I started laughing out loud when
about
I read
what?
It. So this one guy wrote in the comment was like, who the fuck calls her Halsey? Nobody does. It's Halsey. Roxy's an idiot that she didn't know this. It's probably because she's from Boston, which is 100% what happened.
Yeah.
Because everybody from Boston calls her Halsey.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's Halsey. It's wicked Halsey on the stage again. And that is 1,000% what happened. Oh,
and speaking of that, so we kept complaining about how there's no rock music, right?
Yeah.
And then they said I kept getting these requests for this band. What's it called? Emma Summa Summa? I don't know what the hell her name is. Huh. It's not even close. But who performed on Saturday Night Live when Mrs. Maisel was the host?
Oh no, that was the weirdest band I've ever seen.
Greta Van Fleet.
Yeah, Greta Van Fleet.
Great.
Yeah.
Are they?
Yeah.
Oh man,
dude,
really
I watched the SNL thing.
You're just looking at outfits.
No.
Close your eyes.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
But like their music was very, I don't know. Maybe I'm listening to the wrong songs.
I heard a Zeppelin type feel in it.
It does have a Zeppelin feel, but when they were on stage, I was very creeped out by their vibe.
It's because you were looking at the outfits. And my wife had said the same thing, but I said, you know what? I want to listen to, they look like a 70s band.
It wasn't as much as us saying that.
I liked it a lot.
Is it a girl or a guy that's the lead singer?
It's a guy. At first you couldn't tell, but then you could.
It was sort of like Perri Farrell. That first time you saw Perri Farrell, you're like, is that a man or a woman? Yeah.
But what my point then wasn't that there is no rock and roll left, because of course there is, and trust me, that was my dad's world
there's
for
no
so
focus
long.
On it.
It's that they're not nominated. There's no focus.
Yeah. That's what I said to my wife.
It's actually no hip-hop mainstream. Or country.
Yeah. I said, where are these people?
Yeah.
I said, I like these people. Where are they? And Greta Van Fleet, either she's going to be doing a report on CNN or it's going to be... I was like, who
was that? What did you call her?
Greta Van Fleet.
The first time.
No, I don't know. Mimi Moo Moo, I don't know. Yeah. Speaking
she
of which,
called it Summer.
Summer.
Speaking of which, has there been any report from Bobo Bailey about the Oscars?
I don't know. I haven't heard anything.
Still
yet.
Has not been updated.
Yeah. He's standing firm.
Jeremy Bailey said nothing so far.
Yeah. Danny Bailey is up there in his glass tower, just yelling down to all the peasants. I shall not recognize cinematography.
He's not opening the door.
No. I love that he's a cinematographer too.
What's his name though?
Something Bailey.
John Bailey.
Stuart Bailey.
Ken Bailey.
Yeah, thank you.
John Bailey.
We were listening. Roxy was listening back. How long did it take Riley to catch on to the joke?
I think like maybe 45 minutes, honestly. Every time. Every time Riley was like,
I'm
it's like, John.
I'm like,
John Bailey.
What are you doing? Oh, I see what you're doing.
Greta Van Bailey.
But then
Greta Van Bailey.
I love when Riley catches on to a joke because unlike me, who has to let everybody know now I'm in on the joke, I stop the show and I'm like, I get it. Right. I got the. Riley just. Has a little bit of like an eye thing,
and then you move
forward.
Now you smash a plate on the floor and go right.
Right, 100%.
Right.
I got it right.
Yeah, amazing. So anyway, that was the whole thing. There is a Rocha song that someone made. It's a lot more visual than it is. So I'm not going to play it on the show today. But if you want to go check it out, it's the Movie Trivia Schmoedown page. They posted it, and it's like a clip together of the. the El Pollo Loco, commercial.
He deserves a song for that.
It's good.
He's kind of great on this show, I will say. He's one of my favorite guests bring on the show.
Roca's been great.
Yeah.
Well, he's not going to be a guest anymore. He's a regular on Thursdays and Fridays.
Yeah, he's really good.
He's done something very good with the news. I told Reilly when Reilly was out, I thought Rocha brought a nice spin to the news of what he did. Mm-hmm. What I like about what Rocha is doing on the show is that the Rocha that we see in the office, you don't see him a lot on shows. He's in that host mode.
Yeah.
You get to see him here, and that's why I think
that
his personality shines it has on Thursday and Friday. I thought really well. He'll get
it's
into
my
an
favorite
argument.
Version of
it's
him.
Great. Yeah. Like he kicked back both times on Thursday and Friday. He had a lot of fun,
mm-hmm.
and I like to see that side of
him. I'm glad he did because for him to step in and help me out like that, when I was dealing with Cal,
right.
That was like. And for him to juggle everything he was doing, everything here, and be like texting me like wonderful things. The guy is the greatest.
He's been doing good stuff.
I've never really worked that much with Rocha on a show consistently until I started doing Sports Time. And he takes his job very seriously. But once the show gets going and you're able to start ribbing and busting balls, he can hang.
Yeah, he can hang. He always has been. So I'm glad that he's – I think that, to be honest with you, I think he works better on this show than even something on like Movie Talk. Because I think you see more of him and who he is because he can crack jokes. And I think sometimes people think that he takes himself so seriously, because whether it's on the Schmoedown or whatever it is, he's so intense. You saw on Thursday and Friday.
He can take him. The Schmoedown brings out the absolute worst side of him.
And best.
Mostly worse.
Oh, I don't agree.
I feel that way. Yeah. And I find him to be so likable in this room and out there. I want to sock him. Like, I legitimately want to sock him. I want Halsey socked him in the face.
Right. But anyway, Rocha will be back on the show on Thursday and Friday. He'll be running the interview on Friday with Paige. Him and Macuga will be co-hosting the show. Dorina will be on Thursday and Friday.
He's producing as well because I'm going out of town.
So look forward to those episodes because they've been great. And what else? There's something else. Oh, Reilly, you know what I was thinking of because we were talking about How to Train Your Dragon we were. Do you want me to talk about it?
Oh, okay.
Is that okay with you if I continue to talk? All right.
Perfect.
And the caller said that yesterday. I lost it.
I love how there are things. This show has now so many personality bites.
It's so
so good. Many different things. I want to get it. I do. I think we need to get a shirt. But I was thinking about the there was a double feature that you and I went to, and we saw there was two movies that we saw, and it was one of the movies we thought was going to be terrible, turned out to be pretty good.
Okay,
and then there was another one that we thought this could be funny, and it was terrible. Do you remember? Can you name the movies? It was
40-Year-Old Virgin.
Correct.
Just Friends.
There you go.
Yeah.
You thought 40-Year-Old Virgin was going to be crap.
Yeah.
Yes, because we didn't know what we. He and I were.
It was before Apatow, like really. Yeah, Apatow
did. You didn't like Just Friends?
Hated.
Ryan Reynolds?
I hate it. I hate that movie. I think it's the most overrated shitbox. I think he is so unlikable as that character. He's a dick when he's fat, and he's a dick when he's skinny.
I'm with Macuga's face on this one.
Yeah, a lot of people do. I have argued with my friend Eric. What's that?
I watch it every Christmas.
Do you really?
So
people love it.
We put it on, I think, last Christmas, and revisiting it again, I still don't like it.
Yeah. He's a dick. He's a
I'm
dick.
Sorry.
He's
never. There was moments that I was never, fine. You
like,
know,
it's one thing. Like I would understand. Like when he was younger, it's like he was like this good guy, and this, all the stuff was happening, and then like he then lost the weight, became this good looking guy, and became a dick because he was bitter. He was a dick when he was fat. And he was a dick when he was older. Fuck him.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, you know what I mean? I didn't care about him at all.
You haven't been this upset since I like insulted you about winning goldfish here last week, and you jumped down my throat. I'm totally like, they're just friends. Listen, I will stab you on this table.
No. Not when it comes to that. I am definitely a minority. People love that movie.
What made you just think of that? Where did that come from?
Because we were talking about going to see movies whether it was How to Train Your Dragon or when we saw it. And then I remember he and I went to see this double feature. And we saw the pictures of, because I always think that Carell reminds me of Reilly, right? And there was that picture of of Carell with his face out of my. I thought it was going to be this stupid slapstick, dumb comedy that I didn't want anything to deal with. I was like, this is going to be a fart fest, and we loved it. It
was long. Yeah, we walked out of going, that's a great movie.
It was long, but it was good. Yeah. It was before.
I saw 40-Year-Old Virgin and sat next to John Krasinski in the theater at the
Grill. Really?
Yeah, it was just like a random turn of events. That movie, one of my favorite movie-going experiences was 40-Year-Old Virgin because of the same thing. You didn't know what you were getting yourself into. And people were talking about it and said it was funny and said it was funny. And I walked in there and just had an effing blast in that movie.
Yeah. So,
but my buddies waxed my chest as a funny joke.
They did.
The whole thing or one strip?
No, just like three strips.
Him? Jesus. He'd be in a lot of pain.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Just a disaster.
Can't even. Well, maybe
welcome
we'll
to our lives, boys. Welcome to
you
our
don't
lives.
No,
nothing compared to what I have.
It's still not pleasant.
They just have to do it a lot.
It's not fun.
Yeah.
When every 3 weeks you go.
Right. Yeah, I don't want
I don't feel bad for you at all.
Okay. To do with that. I didn't want to be felt bad for. Jesus. Yeah. What am I, Christian and just friends here? God.
See, if it wasn't painful, I'd wax my balls every 2 weeks.
Really?
If it wasn't painful.
Because you like the way it looks better?
It just feels better walking around.
You can't
around.
See down there. You got to be like a freaking contortionist to be able to see what it looks like.
I just want
to
walk around and be like,
sweet.
That's it. If it was just nice, sweet chariot. If it was just nice and it's like a nice like tickle feel, then I'd be good.
Isn't it great how things on the show come all the way around?
It's the
very
first episode
we talked about our balls.
Shaving your balls.
All hours.
Yeah, I remember.
It's great.
Don't say that. We're better than that.
Well, we hit it. I mean, you know, shaving balls
you
we got right here.
Josh gave me a straw that said, I'm better than you.
Yeah.
By the way, I'm glad you reminded me because the same people who made the straws came by and gave me a wonderful gift.
Did they?
Yes, and I
simply straws.
I said to them, "Yes, simple straws." Yeah. I said to them, "I'm going to put this here so I don't lose it," and I haven't touched it since. So I need to go back and get it so I don't lose it.
Yes.
I do that all the time.
I told them. I said, "I got to put it here, otherwise it'll get lost." And I forgot it until this moment.
They made a Josh Macuga for Jeopardy one. They've done Afternoons.
They're really good.
They did Better Than You. Yeah. They did one for Tiffany Smith. They did one for you. Simply Straws people are awesome. And it's like...
I like it. What are is it simplystraws.com?
Simplystraws.com or at simplystraws on Twitter and Instagram.
I like it. Yeah. Dig it.
Awesome.
Thank you
so much. Good people.
All right, let's talk about some news. Anything going on? I mean, there's a lot of news. If you look at the title of the video alone, there's a lot of stuff going on, Reilly. We have... some stuff that we might be interested in, some stuff we might not be. And
well, there's a confusing thing for us. The He-Man and the Masters of the Universe movie is apparently getting ready to shoot this July.
That's crazy.
Whoa.
But wait a minute.
This has been talked about.
But the most recent report was that they just found writers. So what, did they write it in their bathroom last week?
Yeah, I have no idea what's going on. This says, from Production Weekly, updated production schedule and location for Sony's Masters of the Universe from directing duo of Aaron and Adam Nee, principal photography due to get underway mid-July in Prague.
That doesn't sound that crazy to me.
Now,
what if they had a script already?
Yeah, we just found out about the writers, but that doesn't mean that.
No, you're right. They probably could have had something. Can you please make – I'm 100% serious. Who did we yesterday say that you should reach out to the publicist to try to get? Remember we were talking?
Oh, and you said it was a friend, a longtime director that I hadn't...
Oh, Craig Brewer.
Craig Brewer.
No, it wasn't Craig Brewer. Oh. That I can reach out myself. There was somebody else that we talked about that... please make this show because I don't...
From that restaurant?
Yes.
The chef from
Thank
the
you,
restaurant.
Cody.
Yeah.
So the chef, that's please. Right. That's one
oh,
thing.
Oh, yeah, that food's
but I'm good. I'm 100% serious. Please look at who the publicists are for Aaron and Adam Nee, and let's get them in the studio.
We got to talk about this.
I have to find out because I've been so disappointed with everything that everyone has touched with this thing. And most people aren't going to understand it, that this needs to be sci-fi fantasy, that it needs to be Star Wars meets Lord of the Rings. And I need to find out, are they going down the stupid route of trying to mimic Guardians or trying to mimic Thor? Not that those movies are stupid, but they worked for what they were. Don't do that for this movie. You don't need to. So I have to find out.
I don't buy this, though, that they're starting.
You don't
I really
it.
Don't. Yeah, because there's no cast. There's no nothing. I mean, conceivably, we can get a cast leading
soon.
In, you know, very soon.
Well, Well, I think going off Roxy's point, if you set like mid-July, then that means they've had their casting sessions going now.
Yeah.
They want to lock something. The plan is, all right, let's lock down by April, get going, and then start shooting in July.
Man, this has been such a long thing in the work. I know you're passionate about it, Christian, but I don't think you can tell these writers that, like, that this is the way to go with
I'm not going to tell them how to do it. I'm
you
just curious.
I want to
ask them what their approach is. So after I... Yeah. Hey, guys, while you're here, whatever you have, scrap it.
That's
scrap
sort of
it.
Like
here's
how it
ours.
Came out, because you were like,
no, I mean,
listen, MFers, don't make it Just Friends 2, Masters of the Universe.
What I'm saying is I want to find out, and I'm going to, after speaking with them, I would tell Reilly, I feel good. about that these guys are doing it. But if it's like, oh, we're going down that route of like, you know, instead of Rocket Raccoon, it's going to be Orko. I'm like, no. I just it's going to turn out to be like that because that's what the hot thing is now. Because the studio execs were like, well, look, it's going to be Masters of the Universe, but it's going to be think about Guardians and then meets Thor Ragnarok. Successful movies. Sounds good to us, boys. Green light. That's the way that this business works.
What if it's good? What if they do that and it's good?
Always a possibility.
It's always a possibility, but it's just you can get.
It's not what you want.
Nah, you can get three solid movies if you take this thing seriously and stop thinking about the '80s movie because I was in a bad mood at the time, but Nick Mundy and I started getting into a fight because of it.
You and Nick Mundy? Surely
well, because of the '80s, people automatically think of the cartoon and they forget about what the 2002 version was. They forget about what the comics were, and then I got another guy who's like, "Oh, there's no spaceships. I'm Masters of the Universe. You said there were spaceships. There's no spaceships. There's crafts like inside of the actual on Eternia, not outside flying around." This guy was pissed. Like, take it easy, Jack.
I think I got in a fight with Nick Mundy this week too.
You did?
You better listen, Jack. There was something about like Roxy and I had hypothetical questions last week where you can catch it on the TV Talk podcast feed. We pitched a Fullest House where it was basically a continuation reboot, and instead of the uncles, it was aunts, and they're like, "That's what Fuller House is."
By the way, I've watched every episode of Fuller House, so it's not like I didn't know what that is, and that's not what we were pitching. No. We were just pitching something else, and it was
a new show like you went back in time. Basically, you made the show now, but instead of aunts, they were uncles.
And he obviously didn't listen.
So it was a hypothetical.
Correct.
Yeah, and he obviously didn't listen to our show. I love Mundy. We've worked together.
Oh,
a bajillion
Mundy was the
times.
One who went. Okay,
and so Mundy just went it like, "Did you know that this was already the show on Twitter?" And I just was like, "It's actually not what we pitched. Listen to the episode, man. Like, I'm so tired of fighting with him on Twitter.
But
why
be fair
does he
to him
that?
Also too. Right now, he's in the Cody new dad stage too. He doesn't listen to anything. He doesn't have time to listen to anything.
Right. But then don't tweet at me about it.
I know, but that's how I
love him. I really do. We are good friends. He's awesome. But why are you doing that
to make our show
look bad?
Three words: lack of sleep.
Yeah,
that's why he's doing it.
Why was he doing that last year?
I got no answer for you. All right, Reilly. So, do you think that we're gonna get a good He-Man movie from these guys? Be honest. What's your heart of hearts?
I don't know. Leading up to this, if they finally go into production on this, how many years would it be? How many different directors? How many studio changes? How many writers? Yeah. It doesn't look good because of that.
Yeah, the only one that got it right as far as tone went. In my opinion, that the script that I read was Justin Marks.
I'm sure.
Very different from what you and I had originally come up with, but he understood the tone of it.
And both of those, ours and that, then died.
Yeah.
They died, and they moved studios from there.
Yeah. Who's your He-Man right now, if you could pick a He-Man? Or do you go somebody unknown kind of situation?
I'll tell you who I don't like.
Chris Hemsworth.
No, Hemsworth would be all right. I think the problem is then you jump right into the Thor part of it. But and he would have been perfect without Thor. And it's nothing against the guy, but the name that's thrown around is like, no.
John
especially
Courtney.
After this. No.
John Cena?
No. God, no. That's even worse than the one I'm up with. Kellen Lutz has been thrown around there a lot, too.
What do you think about Channing Tatum?
No. Absolutely not.
Cool. Mm.
No.
Good talk.
He's also too he's too little.
How about Taylor Kitsch?
No.
Mm. I like Taylor Kitsch, actually.
Give me an unknown and put some.
Unknown,
put some,
yeah.
And then put someone.
What about Henry Cavill?
No. Give me somebody unknown.
Oh,
and
I
then
love
give
Henry
me
Cavill.
For He-Man? Nah.
Are you going to say no to anybody who is unknown?
Not necessarily. No, Skarsgård would be interesting.
Alexander Skarsgård.
Yeah, True Blood.
Not bad.
He'd
not
be
bad.
Interesting.
What about Joe Manganiello?
Different type of He-Man.
Okay.
This is the greatest Google search in history right here. He-Man actors. Dolph Lundgren. John Irwin, who seems to be an old cowboy.
Oh.
Gary Chalk, who just posted his lawyer photo.
Oh.
Doug Parker, who looks like a scientist.
Yeah.
I have no idea.
And Mark Reilly, who looks like a collegiate professor.
I'll be He-Man. F it.
Why not?
I'm trying to think of like people on TV that I could throw in
there. But that's what I'm saying. Give me Stephen Amell.
Stephen Amell.
It's not bad. He does look like He-Man.
I don't know.
He does.
No.
You could dye Robbie Amell's hair blonde.
I could give me an unknown and make Man in Arms the big star.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's
the Superman.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Unknown and then Gene Hackman.
Alan Richardson.
Or even the King. Make the King.
Do you make Skeletor
CGI.
No, or Michael kind of. Shannon.
Oh. Michael Shannon would be good, but I mean, there's a little Zod action. Yeah. But still, he would be good. There's so many people that could pull off Skeletor for sure.
Powers Booth as Skeletor.
I think he's dead. What about, I think he's really dead.
Powers Booth died.
I think he's dead. This time, I think I'm right. Can we check?
Because so I said many, yesterday, so I am doing,
yesterday I said John Amos
I'm
died. I'm
pretty sure
he's not dead.
I'm pretty sure we did lose.
Yeah, Powers Booth died last year.
Yeah, he died in 2017.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry
about that. Powers Booth.
What about Jesse Plemons as your He-Man?
If he
lost a little weight, got a little shredded up.
I love him.
He's great. He's a good actor.
Listen, we'll find out. We'll find out soon because this whole thing makes me nervous.
Do you remember that dude that came into studio with Tiffany Smith who played the quarterback on Friday Night Lights?
Scott Porter.
He's amazing.
He's good. Porter's interesting. He's little, but he's a little. He'd be a great Prince Adam.
He did.
And the thing is, that's what I'm curious about. What they could do, and it's also what I want to see. What happens? Hold on. It's also what I want to see. What happens with the Scorsese thing? Because the de-aging and the kind of the makeup itself, and look what they did with the Hulk. If they made like Scott Porter would be an amazing Prince Adam.
Yeah.
And then you're able to turn him into this gigantic He-Man thing that made it look real, then maybe. I like the Scott Porter call.
You want a Scott Porter fun fact?
What's that? Yes.
Roommates with Mike Kalinowski in Florida.
That's right.
I did not
They
know
lived
that.
In Florida together?
Yeah.
Yeah. Huh.
Interesting.
He went to Florida State, Scott Porter?
I have no idea, but I know that they lived together. I think it was more in Mike's Disney. Didn't he do Disney World or something there?
Well, yeah. Mike Kalinowski looks like he's 32, but so you never know. He's got the de-aging technology.
He does.
It's ridiculous.
Sure.
All right, let's move on. What else? What else is new?
Oh, is that Norman Reedus as your
Chris Hemsworth.
Oh, Chris Hemsworth. Yeah.
Have you seen the trailer for Yesterday? The new trailer that came out from Danny Boyle.
Yeah.
You got to play along with me, dude. What's it about?
Well, I know what it's about because you told me.
When you go fishing.
Hashtag facts for the kids out there. Yeah. I witnessed that.
I saw that. Yeah.
Well, that died. All right. Yeah. So anyways, Chris Evans. To lead, do you want to talk about
it
yesterday?
Well, you brought it up. You might as well talk about it. Just leave
it's a great
hanging.
Trailer.
Kind of,
I love
nice
the trailer.
To do to people?
Yeah, it's a great trailer. I love the look of it. It's Danny Boyle's movie that he was going to make before James Bond, before he dropped out.
Right.
And it's out there now, and it's a what-if scenario if the Beatles never existed, but one man knew they existed
and
then
steals
used,
all his shit.
And steals all their music,
right.
And he becomes a giant star.
Which of the songs are the Beatles actually letting them use? Because they're real
there
strict
was
about that.
Yesterday in there, Hey Jude.
Ken's music?
Like all of them. Like a whole bunch of them.
There is... Danny Boyle's like obsessed with the Beatles, right? I mean, he did the opening thing for the London Olympics where it was all there's a lot of Beatles songs in there. And he directed that whole thing.
Right.
And so one of the first junkets I ever did was for that movie, I don't know, what was it called? Like Glass or Shattered or something where they like steal a painting and he directed it. And it was like Ewan McGregor, I think, and Rosario Dawson.
Yeah, yeah.
I did that junket and we got to interview Danny Boyle. And there's like seven reporters, and this was before we got video access, or whatever. And I set my phone out there and this woman's like, "Oh, Danny, this was just a feat of cinematic glory. Oh, I haven't seen anything like this in I don't know how long." And I just was like, "What?" Like, I looked under my breath. I was kind of like, "What?" And even Danny Boyle was like, "All right.
Take it easy,
right?" Yeah. And then they started talking about this, but he brought up this project in that junket. He was "I have this Beatles idea that I've been working on forever."
Yeah.
And it's been put on the back burner.
And now he's got it done. So, Alex, are you allowed to talk about the fact that you saw this thing in?
Probably not, so I will not.
Shut up, Alex, and talk into the microphone, you douche!
All right, Alex didn't see the movie.
Hey, Alex!
Yeah, Alex did see the movie, but he can't talk about it. So he knows, he thinks he's better than you, so just know that.
If you were to say, not in words, but let's just say you compared this movie to a restaurant you wanted to go afterwards.
Olive Garden. Let's just say
my favorite was Chili's, and like a not so good one was like Rally Burgers on Culver Boulevard.
Yeah.
Where would you put this?
Good call. What'd you say, Alex?
I'd say Applebee's.
Okay.
Applebee's.
Okay.
So we just got to figure it.
Applebee's is solid.
But that's the thing. We got to find out. We don't know Alex that well.
Yeah, because he like Applebee's.
Is that Mark Ellis talking about Applebee's? Then you might as well run out and go see this movie tonight.
Yeah.
Right.
But if it's, you know.
I love Applebee's.
Me too.
Alex to me seems like somebody you couldn't catch dead in Applebee's.
I don't know. Alex seems like kind of an Applebee's type fella.
I don't know.
Who is eating good in the neighborhood?
That's Applebee's.
That's Applebee's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd like to toss a grenade into the I was going to say the salad bar of
Sizzler?
Chili's.
Chili, I just did
Chili's
that.
Chili's stinks.
Wait, does Chili's have a salad bar for lunch?
It got him sick. Or is it the chili?
No, it was the potato.
No, I got the potato skins. Oh, no, they
I don't
ruined
care. Their
me.
Ribs are dope.
It stinks.
Their ribs
I've never
are dope.
Had Chili's, experience at Chili's.
I mean, either. I love
used,
it.
That one by that we used to go when After we were at AfterBuzz.
Which got me. The one that tried to kill me.
I loved it there.
It was garbage. The only reason we went back is the waitress was so good. And then when they stuck us with some other asshole.
She left.
Oh, yeah, she was great.
She was good.
Kendra?
Yeah. She Kendra. Was cool. And then there's some other one who just
she
couldn't.
Liked Mark Reilly.
Who, the other one?
No, the waitress, oh, remember? Kendra?
Right.
Didn't she like Mark Reilly?
And she left, and then the other one poisoned him.
Yeah, poisoned him.
Right. Is that what happened? Oh, okay. Yeah.
Probably.
I love Sorry. It there. Don't disparage Chili's.
All right, so we got yesterday, and then we don't remember the rant. Oh, you maybe don't remember the rant. Reilly went off on Chili's. Can you see if that clip exists? Where just type in Mark Reilly goes off on Chili's.
I like Chili's.
Yeah, it was the worst.
When was this?
It was phase four. 2014, 15. Yeah. Phase five.
Yeah.
Phase
five. Yeah. It's almost 5 years ago.
I'm a big Chili's gal.
Me
yeah,
too.
Let's,
guy.
It ruined me.
Just for go to the videos, guys.
Months.
I don't remember where it is.
I was like 4 months into dating my future fiance. And having that much pain and then having to go to the doctor, it was the most
Wait, what happened?
Bring in cake time. Yeah, that's fine. Go to that one.
It was like a kind of a food poisoning. It gave me a colitis. I had to go get
Hold on real quick. I want to show you guys this because I don't know if you've ever seen this, Roxy. Talk about me. You haven't seen a drunk Harloff in a while. This is a drunk Harloff. I'm sitting there with my cake.
Oh, God.
And we got they'll probably get demonetized for this. Here we go. We're at room five. Nice cake everybody wanted me to eat. Face into the cake. I had enough to
was
drink
it your
that
birthday?
Night. Oh yeah. I had enough to drink, and I just look how long I stay there.
Yeah, you stay there for
look,
so
I'm,
long.
No, just leave it. Just leave it for a second. I'm like
currently still yeah,
look,
in the cake.
I'm not leaving that cake.
Update.
Like, look,
the news
I'm there.
Are you
like,
doing
look,
tongue stuff?
No, in look. The cake. And it's the second shot.
There's just random glasses all over the place.
Let the video go for a bit, because look, I mean that's. You don't see that face often.
Yeah.
That is.
Oh, you're hammered.
Oh, man, that was
look
old school.
Look at that face.
Yeah, it goes for a bit, and then.
Heath Ledger's The Joker was based off that face, actually.
Yeah.
Oh, is that Bonnie Somerville?
Yeah.
Oh, there you go.
And it's like.
Overdressed per usual.
Well, I think she was coming back from an event. What did I say? I say something about Dark Knight.
Is it your birthday that day?
Yeah.
It's your cake.
I said something about Dark Knight.
So you are the Dark Knight in this one. You're Heath Ledger.
A real hero. I don't know what happened to that cake. What a waste of food. It looked like the Incredible Hulk. Yeah, it's Tom Connelly. Anyway, so.
Where's that picture? We need to
Room
see.
Five.
Yeah, there's room. Yeah, and it's not, God, doesn't exist anymore.
Room five.
Almost went right out.
I was at a restaurant, too, right underneath.
It was great.
I'm so
Alfie.
Good.
It was really
I
good.
Missed this phase of your life.
Yeah, you
which
did.
Which is sad.
You're lucky. Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
There was a reason that Christian and I didn't become friends until after this.
We would have gotten arrested.
For sure.
Yeah.
There isn't a doubt in my mind.
Prime Macuga, prime Harloff.
The jumping fences, kicking down doors, just God. Misbehavior.
I don't feel like I missed this phase of your life.
No, you caught that part.
I caught that.
You caught the
life.
Tail end.
Yeah.
You caught the tail end.
Yeah.
And I was looking at a mirror. Basically, yeah. That would have been interesting. We always say it. 2006 Harloff combined with 2012 Macuga would have been something.
Nightmare. That one time we went over to your house for the pasta dinner.
Yeah.
And I was the first one to arrive at your house, and I'm talking to your wife in the kitchen. You're in there, and you're kind of popping back and forth. And I was telling the story of the night before, and she was like, "You're just my husband," and she walked out of the kitchen.
It's true.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's pictures of me from like 2008. No, not 2008. It was 2007. It was the year I met my wife.
Nine?
No, it wasn't 2009. It might have been...
Eighth.
Not the eighth. Eighth
nine!
Very
sexy. Nine!
Could have been the ninth. It was 2007.
Speaking of the high in the heist, nine!
That was probably what I was singing. But I fell asleep. I had such a... It was the year... I was still single.
Mm-hmm.
Hammered at my birthday party again. It always seemed to be. Fell asleep on my stairs. There's pictures of it with my... It was like a really bad Nike ad. Like, the Nikes are just popping out. I think, like, being out with, like, my ex-girlfriend,
mm-hmm.
who, at the time, I think, had a... I don't know if she married. I have no idea. But anyway.
Just do it.
Yeah, it was one of those things, too. It was just one of those days. You've been there.
Oh, yeah.
And then that was the end of it. That was, like, the last hurrah.
That would have been the best if 2007, at my Halloween party, we had Macuga then enter that mix. That would have been...
It would have been...
My duplex I rented would have fallen to the ground in flames.
Now you caught the tail end... Not the tail end. You caught Prime during your Halloween parties.
Yeah, the Halloween parties. Yeah. CPK, God's sakes.
That's CPK.
Jesus.
Well, that was before that. Yeah. Jeez. Yeah. Thank God that one-on-one didn't happen.
Roxy just sitting there awkwardly. I don't know what they're talking about.
No.
No, she's getting excited. She wants to learn more.
I just would have been right next to you guys.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like that.
I know.
It's very similar.
It is. It's like putting again, like Tyson and
Ali
and Ali and
Frazier.
And Layla Ali.
Yeah,
putting them all together.
I'll never forget when Ben came home to like meet my family, and they were going and telling him all these stories about me, because I'm just not the same person. You catch a little bit of it on one-on-one too, and it's just like looking in the mirror for you guys. Yes, like just. Yeah. Hammered all of the time.
That's it.
Because every drunk mistake you can make, that person in your group of friends,
right.
I was you guys.
Yes.
In my group.
Uh-huh. Again, this is why we hope we don't have a lot of kids listening to this show, because this is not for you.
Whoops. All right.
What's what's next?
Deadline, Antoine Fuqua is doing a sci-fi movie with Chris Evans. And it's interesting. It's called Infinite, and it's a man that's haunted by memories of two past lives, and we learn that there's a secret society of people that remember these lives, and they try to shape history through their experience, and that's Chris Evans wants to join their ranks.
That's cool. You know?
Yeah.
I love this kind of shit.
It's alternate timeline BS.
That's made for me. Yeah. I love that time.
Same.
Yeah,
I'm so tired of timelines and multiverses and flashbacks, because I know that's what Endgame's going to be. They're like, we got to get on another timeline, and we got to figure out how to undo the snap. If we get in this little bowl, we're going to get there, and everybody's going to be psyched, and then all the dust is going to come back. I know what it's going to happen. It's going to be enjoyable, but I know what's going to happen. It's a multiple timeline.
But I like the multiple timeline if it's done correctly. Yeah. If it's done well, if it doesn't get too confusing. What was the one that
did? Not that though. It's past lives.
Right.
It's not multiple timelines.
Not this. Right. This is something completely different. But I past lives, multiple timelines.
Yeah.
I like that. This kind of stuff. I like the past lives stuff. I like the and sci-fi to me.
Did you guys read Many Lives, Many Masters?
No.
Never mind. Keep going. Sci-fi to you. It's interesting if you like that kind of thing, Christian. I think you'd be really interested in it.
Well, remind me, because otherwise I'll forget it with the straw.
I will remind you.
Yeah.
Keep going.
All right. Well, I want to see that movie. I want to see it.
I think what happened was the Flash soured me. All those CW shows just
definitely
soured me.
Did, because that's what you think about every single time.
Right. Yeah. Is that now that everybody's like, oh, there's a multiple timelines, let's go. The only movie that I actually enjoyed the multiple timeline is Back to the Future 2, because we got like a step. Every other time I get so, and maybe I'm just a simple man. I'm simple Josh, right? I'm simple Jack.
Yosh.
I'm simple Yosh.
Simple Yosh.
Simple Yosh.
As soon as we start getting all these timelines, like, you know, I don't like the movie Inception. I just don't like it. And I know it's like your favorite, okay?
I know.
Yeah. But listen, he likes Just Friends and Let's Be Cops.
I'm a simple man. I like comedies. I like straightforward stuff. I'm not like a giant sci-fi guy. I like the superhero movies because of the personalities, not because of the fight scenes and all this kind of stuff. Because the fight scenes get boring time after time after time. It's just like weapon, slide across, hit a building.
There was a movie recently.
That's every superhero movie. That's why Man of Steel stinks.
But there was a
movie
are you thinking?
Don't
of,
make
Christian?
Me go to Twitter.
I don't know. There was a movie recently that dealt with like multiverses and came back around. And it just made a lot of sense the way that it just tied in together. And I was like, oh, it made sense. What the hell was it? It was something
Back to the Future.
No, it was something in the last like 6 months.
Huh.
I don't know. Like the way that it
Annihilation.
No, was it Annihilation?
I can't Game remember. Night.
I have to go through it. Yeah,
Infinity
I don't know.
Infinity War.
No, it wasn't Infinity War. It was something that just it all. I was like, you know what? This really made sense. It could have been really confusing, but the way that they set it up, and I loved it. I can't remember what the movie was.
Spider-Verse.
Yes, that's exactly what it was. It was Spider-Verse. Yes. The Spider-Verse. Spider-Verse did it.
And I will give you Spider-Verse simply because it was the comedy of it all was entertaining, and it was an animated movie.
But it wasn't confusing. It made sense to with the way that the story kind of interweave. Thank you for getting me there.
Well, I remember on Collider Live, you said that exact sentence.
That was it.
I pay attention to you, despite what people say.
Yeah.
I have to bring up something.
Uh-oh.
And I wanted to bring it up at the top of the show, but this is movie news, sort of.
Okay.
I watched this movie last night on Netflix. It's a documentary. Oh. And now that we've been on Three Identical Strangers, I tweeted about it last night.
Okay? What was it?
It's called Abducted in Plain Sight.
Oh, I saw the trailer for it. Yeah, I can't watch that.
Christian, It is the most bonkers movie of idiocy I've ever seen.
How so?
So the premise is that this guy moves in next door. He's got a wife and family and five kids.
Wait, are you going to give spoilers right now? Because we got to tell the people.
No. And he moves in and he's this like charming guy. And all of a sudden he is he's like tranced their whole family into loving him. And it just goes bonkers from there. I'm telling you, it is the most absurd documentary I've ever seen.
In a good way, in a bad way. I can't tell if you like it.
Both. I watched it all the way through. Amanda and I were like glued to the television. We weren't on our phones. We weren't doing anything. I was glued to this movie. It is unlike anything I've ever heard.
Really?
It is a family. Better? It is a comedy of errors, of ridiculous idiocy.
Better than Three Identical Strangers? Different.
Way different.
Okay.
Three Identical Strangers is an incredible story.
Right.
This story is just like, who are you? You dumb idiots. Like, every turn, the parents are like, well, we like thought it was a pretty good idea, and then he stole our daughter.
Are they just dumb people?
I don't know.
Do they seem dumb?
They seem dumb.
Okay.
But then is it like a must watch? For them.
I don't feel bad. Oh. I don't feel bad at all.
Is the kid okay, though?
I felt bad for the daughter. I really did.
Is
I
the kid okay? The
kid is okay now. Nobody dies.
Okay.
Is okay a relative term?
No, yes, but I just mean I meant dead. That's why I wouldn't want to watch it. Yeah. I don't want to see anything about kids getting taken.
No, nobody's getting killed. Did you watch it?
No, it's up my alley.
Watch it immediately so that we can all be on the same page. So that like going forward as people, we can be like, don't abduct in plain sight this, right? Like, don't do this.
Right.
It's from Pocatello, Idaho. Whatever. Somebody tweeted me like, that's my hometown.
No,
Idaho. Thank you, Roxy. Mm-hmm. Kristian, it is.
You're baffled.
Maybe
that's why you're disheveled.
Probably.
There's something in the air.
I had the weirdest
dreams
last night.
Everybody was all of a sudden started tweeting at the same time. You're Snyder,
Elliot.
I like that Reilly says this is up my alley. Kidnappings.
He's true crime. A lot of dark shit going on in your head.
It keeps me sane. It keeps me level.
When I watched An Innocent Man, which was based on this John Grisham book, it was a documentary. It was like, this story is almost too crazy to believe. I watched all six episodes. I was like, I can believe it. It's just like a bunch of idiot cops doing stupid stuff, right? This one is just like, who? What? Are you? This is the dumbest set of people ever put into a room together procreated.
All right, I'll have to check that out.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, if it's a bunch of morons, then why not?
It's fun.
Okay.
It's fun. And then terrible. It's terrible. I don't want to say it's funny.
Right.
It's a terrible comedy of errors, led by the parents.
All right. Well, I'll have to check that out. Riley, what's next?
Yeah. So we got some breaking news, everyone.
Ooh. Okay.
I love it when this happens. What so the Breaking Bad movie has officially been announced.
Okay. Whoa.
It is going to air on Netflix.
Whoa.
And then it's going to then follow up before running on AMC again.
So
and they might
the
break it up. The story is going to pick up directly after the events of Breaking Bad, and it's going to follow Jesse.
Okay.
And Jesse, per THR, will follow the escape of a kidnapped man, Aaron Paul's Jesse, and his quest for freedom. No word yet on whether or not Walter White will be involved. You can probably look at this and go, nope.
In flashbacks, maybe.
Flashbacks, possibly, yeah. So, but it's the distribution plan that people are looking at. It's going to air all on Netflix, and then they're going to release it on AMC and probably, you know, break it up into episodes.
Yeah, Vince Gilligan.
Vince Gilligan is going to direct.
Oh, that's
and,
good. Okay,
they announced
on board.
The budget.
Yeah. I don't know about the budget, no.
Remember when you were talking about teams yesterday and how, like, Timothée Chalamet created the Chalamet him and his team?
Yeah.
I talk about a team of people that just put Aaron Paul into nothing after Breaking Bad. I don't know if that was his choice or what, but that dude made that show. I know everybody's like,
what was that
White,
Hulu show that he did?
The Path. I couldn't get into The Path. It was very weird.
And he was in the Need for Speed that didn't.
Nothing. Yeah. You know, I'd love to see Aaron Paul in something again. And this excites me. The dude is a great actor.
He's also a really cool dude.
Yes.
Yeah.
I would be surprised. I think everybody wants to work with him. The couple times I've met him, he's been a doll face. Yeah. And he's really talented.
Super talented.
I don't know what happened.
Did you ever see his episode of Price is Right?
No.
As a contestant. Yeah.
Yeah, before he was famous.
Yeah,
he was
incredible.
Yeah, he was to the final thing, and he got screwed at the very end. Yeah, look, that's when he lost.
Yeah.
He was
young Aaron Paul.
Yeah. But it was.
He looks like Josh Macuga in college. Glasses, buzzed head.
You can see the clip. Bring up the clip real quick, Cody, just the video itself, because you can have. It'll play for sound. Where, I like Aaron Paul, man. I want to see the fact that it's following Jesse.
Yeah.
Directly. There you go. Hold on. This is. Yeah, you can see the energy from him.
He's so excited.
Yeah. I mean, he's talked about this, obviously. The little. Looks like he's floating. Look how skinny he is.
He's so skinny.
He's super skinny. I mean, he's got to be, 20 years old or something? Like, listen to him. Yeah.
I have the horrible feeling I have another one.
It is. Yeah, yeah, he loses. He loses his mind.
Like, it's so good.
It's good. You've never seen this, Rocha?
No.
Yeah.
Aaron, what do you bid on that?
$1,200.
It's going nuts.
$1,797.
Yeah, and he's jumping up and down and he's losing it. But watch him when he gets up. I mean, he does a good run here.
These are his buddies.
Yeah. Right? Oh yeah. I wonder if he's like kept in touch with all those cats too. Yeah.
Look at he's got the keys on the chain.
Yeah, yeah.
That's so cute. Right,
this is the end.
No matter how far you miss.
Yeah.
Your bid is $26,500. Aaron, the actual retail price of your showcase is $26,368.
No.
He went over by $135
bucks.
Bucks. Yeah.
$15.
Oh.
So little by 30.
Brutal.
Brutal.
Oh, and it's a sports car.
Yeah.
About like not much.
Look at him. Yeah, you probably could buy like 20 of those now. Isn't that great? Yeah, it's really good.
Poor Aaron.
And he's probably thinking up there like, this is the best moment of my life.
And little did he know.
Yeah.
The girl goes over, all you have to do is bet nothing, but that's the part of the showcase showdown.
Yeah.
It's amazing. Know your numbers.
All right, so that's the Breaking Bad movie. And what's going on now with this? So Stallone posted something yesterday. Stallone posted something.
What, IG?
What? On Instagram? Yeah, bring that up, Riley, because we should say, oh, wait, you didn't put that in the title. It's supposed to be He-Man, Frozen 2, and Rambo. As Rambo, yeah.
It said, "Oh my, no Rambo in there."
Well, that's your fault. Put
it
the
is,
third.
Huh? Here, I got a text I want to read.
Yeah,
to you.
Yeah, I think
quick.
It is. You don't.
Jay, oh, I missed it.
Yeah.
It is, right? Did I put Rambo?
Man,
yeah, but I didn't even know. Yeah, you did put Rambo. My apologies.
Thought so. Let's bring up that picture.
But what is it?
Stallone live in
the
concert.
Sorry, yeah,
is Tom Dagnino at that show?
No, we posted. So Stallone posted on Instagram a picture of John Rambo in military garb, like all of his accomplishments and things that he had done, which is awesome. This is Rambo at 20 years old. War start on the outside, but never on the inside, said John.
War start on the outside, but never the inside, said John in 68.
Wow.
wasn't an Air Force chopper pilot in 70, transferred to Special Forces in 75, enlisted in Delta Force from 77 to 78. I love this. This is Rambo's last hurrah.
Did he put himself, like, did he Photoshop
himself? Yeah,
somebody,
that's
awesome.
Yeah, he
that's
Photoshopped awesome. Himself. And look at him. Look at young Rambo.
You're psyched about Stallone and Rambo, obviously, because it's one of the greatest film franchises of all time.
Easily.
And if somebody comes at me and is like, oh, that most recent Rambo wasn't good, you're an idiot. That Reeves Rambo was awesome.
It was 10 years ago.
It's awesome.
10 years ago.
Also, on YouTube yesterday, Will Smith posted first month on Bad Boys, and it's a 10-minute YouTube video behind the scenes.
Did you watch every second of it?
Yeah, like three times. Right. It was amazing.
Yeah, I'm just over the moon for this one, and I'm mad at myself because our Schmoedown writer, Chris Skaliski, had said, super shocked because he watched my most anticipated list, Harloff didn't put Rambo in there. Yeah, I'm an idiot.
Yeah.
Because I forgot it was coming out this year because there's no really. Where's the release date on it?
We don't have any.
We didn't have a release date on it.
Yeah, it's like they say October.
Right.
Yeah, but so they're like.
Then when I was going through the release schedule, it wasn't on there because it's not on the release schedule. So it is absolutely. It's in my top three. I don't know what I would pick over this or the Avengers.
That was my question. You're so giddy. It was like Snyder with glass.
Oh, no.
I
want to see how it ends. I want to see his Rambo's not. I can't imagine. I mean, I always think everyone's going to die, but I mean, the fact this has got to be his last one. It's
What if he rides off into the sunset? Will that be okay?
I mean, it's going to be interesting. He's taking on. I mean, he's going full. Look at him. He's like, this is PTSD. He's going straight up.
Kristian wants Cody to have a tough pregnancy. I don't think he's the kind of guy who wants somebody to ride off in the sunset.
Yeah,
and
no kidding.
I don't know.
It's like, I hope everybody's in pain and has nightmares.
Well, remember, in the original,
John
in the novel,
Rambo.
The 72 novel by Dave Morrell, the Rambo dies. He dies.
That's right.
Because he's redeemable in First Blood, in the movie.
In the movie.
In the movie, he's redeemable. In the book.
He's dark.
He kills everybody.
Yep.
Like, so he runs out. In the movie, he runs out and he punches a cop like in the head and takes off into the woods. In the book, he guts a motherfucker and runs out and he kills everybody. I mean, he kills everybody. He kills all the cops. They're dead. Like, they're
Terminator stuff.
Well, they're coming after him. And he's like, don't come after me. I'm going to kill you. And they come after him. So he kills him. But he doesn't. He's not killing anybody in First Blood Even when he throws like a rock at the helicopter and the guy falls out, it's just like trying to protect himself. So, because in the movie, the original movie, the ending, they did kill him and it didn't work. Plus, Stallone smartly was thinking, we need a franchise for this.
Yeah.
And so they kept him alive. But I think there's nowhere else that Rambo can go.
No.
He fights a drug cartel and then, I've done my time.
Gives his life.
This is like a hidden talent of yours that you haven't.
Have you ever heard of Stallone before? Oh, yeah. Man, it's so good.
Perfect.
I think it's really good than impressions. It's better than your Arnold, even.
Oh, I don't know about that.
Oh,
I
can, my God.
I can talk.
I like your Arnold.
But I don't know if I can talk like Arnold.
What do you mean?
You talk like Arnold. You don't even talk like
Stallone.
Do the
elephant thing. Whatever. What was
that? I'm saying I can talk.
Yeah.
He's going into the woods, and I was looking, and I saw an elephant, and I said, "What are you doing here, elephant? You don't belong in the woods." And he said, "I can't talk. I'm an elephant."
Do that as Stallone.
Saw the elephant and was wondering, "Hey Arnold, was the elephant here?" And he said, "I don't know." That was it.
Dude, now do Stallone.
Now do Statham, and then we got like Expendables 5 going here. Like,
holy crap.
You understand that. I was looking at the elephant. You know what I mean? Which elephant? What was he? He got drunk in the water. You know what I mean?
That one's not good. All it is, you know what I mean?
It was not bad. Yeah. Holy crap.
And then we have Van Damme. Let's send in Van Damme real quick.
Want some cookies?
And the elephant said.
I said, yeah.
And then he said.
You want a glass of milk?
And the elephant said.
I said, yeah.
There you go.
And Gary Busey, I believe the elephants are from Mars. I had a conversation with an elephant last week who told me that I'll have a toupee inside of my left armpit.
When you do that one, your cheek shakes.
Yeah.
You have to.
Unbelievable. Mr. Stallone, can you put me in a movie? I was once in a movie with Mel Gibson and Buddy Holly.
No, actually, you played Buddy Holly.
I ate Buddy Holly's shoe.
Thank you.
Thanks for everything.
I am shocked right now.
With Gary Busey?
No, just how good you are at that.
Yeah. No, it's easier to do on the radio.
The best was when you were working on that Jack Nicholson and you were leaving me voicemails and you were like calling me and you were trying out as Jack Nicholson, and then we were about to do the celebrity impression dating game. And
JT.
And then JT's like, I'm Jack Nicholson. And Kristian was like, no!
I go, no, because they're working on it, and I can't even do it anymore. So, hey, it's your old pal Jack here.
You better listen, Jack.
Trying to.
Dang.
Yeah, so those are the only ones. It was working on, who was a few of them. But Stallone to me is back as Rambo. I'm excited. Looking forward to it. I love that picture. So what else? What else we got?
That's about it for news, other than Frozen 2 getting that trailer.
So the trailer came out. How you like it?
I actually really liked it.
You did?
Yeah, I really liked it. It was like a little bit dark.
Oh.
There was not a lot of plot to it. Oh. But it hints at there's something going on.
Hints.
Okay. At something, and there's some good music.
Man.
Yeah. I liked it. Yeah. I liked it. It was a good teaser. Didn't give you a lot. It gave you the people. It gave you enough.
That's this year?
It comes out in August, I believe.
Disney is like
machine.
It's juggernaut.
It's like that. What's a bad movie? The Immortal Instruments. Not the Mortal Instruments.
Mortal Engines.
Mortal Engines. So that one that Peter Jackson produced.
Yes.
It's like those cities that just take over everything and just eating everything up. That's like Disney right now.
Yeah.
It's like for better or for worse. It's like, you know, whatever you think. There's a lot of good movies out there that they're putting out, but they are just eating everything.
Yeah. Sorry. It's November 22nd is when it comes out, and I mean, if you think about this, we got
Thanksgiving
March. Yeah. It's like March is Dumbo, then and Captain Marvel, then it's Aladdin in May, and then it's
Avengers,
and then it's Lion King,
Star Wars, Frozen. I mean, get out of the way. D23 is going to be stacked this year. Oh, you know what? D23 though, will it be? Because the question is, D23 is like in October. All their movies will pretty much have come out.
Well, what do they have the next year?
True. I don't know. I don't know what it is next year.
But they still don't have. You're probably going to get like an updated scene from Frozen because it hasn't been released yet. You'd probably get Star Wars stuff at D23.
True.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Yeah.
You might get some teasers
for next year. Oh, yeah, let's see what they have. Go back up, Cody. So we have. Go back up. What are you doing? That's down, Cody. All right. Untitled.
We got the wrong year. Hold on.
No.
2018 to 2023.
They're gonna do Pinocchio live action. I think they've been talking about it for a while. This is 2020. All right.
Yeah, that might not happen.
So I don't know what Onward is. So Onward comes out. This is the Disney. Onward comes out in 2020. What is that? Pixar's first?
Oh, that's the fantasy land where they're like, you know, Lord of the Rings type creatures.
Oh, okay.
Oh, well, yeah.
Why is there a picture of...
They're voicing. Because
they're voicing.
Oh, I see. Okay, keep going down then. So Onward. And then Mulan comes out in 2020.
Maleficent.
I have no interest in that movie whatsoever. But Maleficent 2. Comes out in May. Yeah, no thanks, but it'll make a lot of money because the first one did good. But
Maleficent.
Next one. Pixar, another untitled Pixar animation comes out in June.
Oh,
Jungle Cruise. I think is it Shane Black? No, it's not Shane Black. It's what's his face? Jaume Collette.
Yeah,
and Emily Blunt in The Rock. Okay,
sure.
Not a Disney live action movie. We don't know what that is.
Okay. Just Kenneth Branagh.
Yeah, keep going. Same thing. So we don't know yet. So it's not as stacked as this year. Not even close. I mean, I've never seen a stack of a movie.
They just keep throwing stacks.
They have a lot of stuff, but not the way that they do this year.
This year's insane.
Their big franchises are coming out throwing bombs. So, okay, look, when we get back from break, we're going to go to break, and we have Perri Nemiroff going to join us in studio, shoot the shit a little bit more, maybe hear from you guys a little bit. And then at 11:30, Jay Baruchel coming in to talk about How to Train Your Dragon 3. Clatter Live. Hello, Collider fans. I'm Kristian Harloff, and you see my stupid name in the background because that's my other show. It's One-on-One with me, Kristian Harloff. What the hell is it? I just sit down and talk to people. I literally just sit down and talk to people about what the hell's going on in their lives and their careers, and it's a long-form interview show. Originally, it aired on Collider Video as far as the YouTube channel goes, but we moved it on over, and it's on the Collider Podcast, on YouTube. Go on over there if you want to see the video and to see the pretty faces that I'm talking to. Had some great guests over the past. And we're going to have a lot more. And there's going to be people that you, maybe some celebrities or actors and actresses, producers, writers, all that stuff. But there's also a lot of the people that you know around here. I could have Copster on there. I could have Jeff Snyder, John Rocha, Mark Reilly, Roxy Striar, whoever. And I'm going to find out more about them. Long form, and also go to Apple Podcasts and check out the One-on-One feed with Kristian Harloff. And not only is my show on there, Mark Reilly, the Reilly Roundtable, which is another sit-down, long-form interview show, that's also there. And when Steve Frosty Weintraub talks to Kevin Smith or George Takei, that's going to be on that podcast feed also. So if you're taking a long drive and you like those long-form interviews, pop on the One-on-One with Kristian Harloff. Give it a rate, comment, do all that because it helps the show and it makes Podcast One go, hey, you know what? Those people should get ad money.
Oh, hi, guys. It's Perri here, and I am going to tell you about The Witching Hour. It is the show that I host along with Collider.com's Haley Fouch. It is in podcast form on the Collider Factory feed, and we also have the video up and running every Tuesday for you right there on the Collider Podcast YouTube channel. We talk about everything horror. We're talking TV, movies, the newest releases. We talk about movies that are celebrating anniversaries. We've even talked about books. It's crazy. If it is scary, we are talking about it on The Witching Hour. We also have so many filmmaker interviews, really cool stuff. It's all coming your way every single Tuesday on The Witching Hour. Check it out. Collider Factory and the Collider Podcast YouTube channel.
Hello, Collider Live. My name is Amy Dallin.
And I'm Corey Jandro, and we host a little show we love called Collider Heroes. And it is all of the things we love about movies, TV, comics themselves, all the breaking news, trailers, photos, but not paparazzi photos.
Okay. All of the superhero stuff we love, all of the indie comic stuff we love, all the stuff you had no idea was based on comics.
80 years of comic lore have led to this show and many years in film and TV, and we're living in a golden age of comics, and we want to share all of that zeal with you folks.
So we talk about the stuff that's coming out. We talk about what we hope is coming out. We do fantasy casting of things that should exist. Why don't they exist?
And we do your Twitter questions asking directly to us what we think of certain things. And every single week, since we both actually love and read physical comics by in print, we have a comic pull list where our five biggest favorite books of the week come out, and we dive into those with you guys.
You can buy digital. I'll forgive you. As long as you're paying for your comics, it's all good.
But if you buy in print, you can bag them and board them, and then they're worth more later, because comics are like certain things from the 90s that are totally worth the value. Buy comics. Buy in print. Digital's never worth anything later. Buy in print. Keep comic stores alive.
Or we can debate collector's items all day long. We can debate casting. We can debate movie news. We can have all of our friends come join us, as we frequently do. We can ask professionals about their work. We've had some amazing guests come by the show.
Yep. We try
and you
to
can catch it every Wednesday.
That are on these properties that also love comics. You hear what it's like from their perspective, from inside, from outside. And this is all with the focus of bringing all this news to you guys. And we're here every Wednesday on Collider. And we love this stuff. We want to share it with you guys.
We'll see you then.
Hey guys, Reilly here, and let me tell you about the Reilly Roundtable. That's right, they gave Reilly his own podcast. The Reilly Roundtable is on its new home, and that is one-on-one with Kristian Harloff on the iTunes feed for Podcast One. It drops every Thursday. The Reilly Roundtable is a little bit about everything. It's about movies and life and movies and everything in between. I like to have my special guests for discussions like Justice League versus Batman v Superman, for discussions about wine tasting, for discussions about UFOs, and everything in between. That's right, the Reilly Roundtable drops on Thursdays on the One-on-One with Kristian Harloff podcast feed, and later on Collider Video's own podcast video network. So check it out every Thursday, the Reilly Roundtable. See you there.
Hey everyone, this is John Rocha. You know me as one of the co-hosts for Collider Sports Time every Monday on Collider Sports YouTube and podcast channel. But we got another show on here. That's Collider Sportsbook. Josh Macuga, the Wild Man, he hosts that one. I join him on those, and they're a lot of fun. We break down the lines and the predictions with the over and unders. A lot of stuff going on for all the NFL games and some select college football games as well. We do that every week. We also do special ones on Thursday nights for those Thursday night football games. Let you know where to put your money, what bets to put down, who to go with, who not to go with. We give you a lot of information, and we give you our thoughts. You know, Josh Macuga, he does it by the gut. I do it more from the statistics point of view, and every once in a while, Mark Fernandez even joins us to throw in his 2 cents on the Thursday night sports book. So there's a lot of sports action here on Sports Time, on the Collider Sports YouTube and podcast channel. Join us there. Subscribe there. Definitely on the podcast channel. We need your downloads, subscriptions, and views there. So give us some love on Collider Sports, and we'll talk to you soon.
The hell is
that? Don't know what this is, but man, it sounds really good.
Is this from like Crash Bandicoot?
Sounds like SpongeBob or something.
You're close, Josh.
What is it?
It's Mario
video
Kart
game.
You're also close, Rocky.
Oh,
Super Smash Brothers?
Mario Castle.
Yoshi? No.
Diddy Kong Racing.
I have to tell you that it's not fun to be on Roxy's shit list.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody's on your shit list.
Yeah, I think he knows probably too.
Does he
kind of made a face like I know what I did.
Did Alex go in there and stink the bathroom up?
No, it wasn't a stink it up situation. It was a leave the toilet seat up and just like, I expect better.
From Alex?
Yeah. Well, because I know that he's young and maybe, you know.
Is he? See, I think Alex to me
I actually have no idea how old he is.
He's like, I think he's got a Kalinowski type thing. I bet you Alex is like 46.
Alex?
Hmm.
He left.
Okay.
He's 25.
Oh, fine.
I just am not a fan. It don't leave your seat up. Don't leave it up, especially when you know that you're working with him.
But
and he saw I was coming in after him.
Right.
So don't do that.
But isn't
hold on, he's walking.
Okay.
I used the urinal.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
So you didn't leave it up.
Ooh.
So someone else left it up.
Mystery.
Did
the
I
plot
no, I didn't
thickens.
I went in the men's bathroom. Because I always leave it up.
I went in the men's bathroom. The urinal.
Oh, you went in the men's bathroom.
Because Macuga was having some issues in the women's one.
I left it up.
That's okay.
Yeah. So then, he shouldn't be in there in the first place.
What do you mean? What is I supposed to do?
So why am I going to leave the seat up if it's not meant for ladies?
It doesn't say women and men. It says women and unisex.
Oh, no. Yeah. I have no sympathy for you right now.
Like
if, if it was a women's bathroom, then yeah.
I think that you go to all these bathrooms now, which is like gender neutral, so everybody just leaves the seat down. Put the seat down.
Put the seat down.
And pee in the urinal.
I don't want to touch your dirty seat.
Use your foot.
It's kind of hard. I'm really small.
Kick it.
I've almost landed in the toilet so many times. You should watch me trying to do that.
Yeah.
Wow.
I already tried to flush with my foot.
Wow.
Yeah. I was going to say, to see Roxy fall, we should put a video camera. And then I started to hear myself say, put a video camera in the bathroom.
Let's not do that.
Nah.
Let's hashtag that some other time.
Macuga fell asleep on the toilet. Yeah. It takes a while.
You've done that before.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Same. Not have we not all?
Yeah.
I've never fallen asleep on the toilet.
I think one time when I was really, I think when my first daughter was born, I was really exhausted and then took a little bit of a rest.
Siesta.
And then it was, oh, wait, it's morning. Yeah, one of those things.
I thought we were talking about a drunk situation.
No,
we
no. I've never done that. No, see, when I get, I don't drink anymore as much as I, obviously, we were talking, like cake time. But when I did, like I would get to a place to where I just, I get home, doesn't matter, the second I walk in, clothes are off, yeah. Right on the floor. And then I just go to sleep on the floor.
You're the dad in Goldberg's.
Is that what he does?
You're Jeff Garland. He
takes off his pants.
Yeah. Oh, that's what I do. I would go home. I'm going right to the boxers.
Yeah.
Let's go to sleep.
I'm with you.
How do they show that on TV?
He's just wearing tiny whities.
Jeff Garland.
Jeff Garland. It's hysterical.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like they like do a close up on it. It's a wide shot.
Yeah. It's been on for a while.
Tons.
You love that show, right?
Love it. Yeah. It's like, I think it's going on a 6th or 7th season now. And
one of the best.
Modern Family just got its renewed for its final 11th season.
I don't know.
I'm still with it.
Yeah.
With Modern Family?
Yeah. I'm still so with it. I love that show.
Never miss
it. What they're doing with Haley's character is like bringing new life to the show.
Modern Family to me is, I feel the same way as I felt about Seinfeld, in where I appreciate how great of a show it is and how funny it is. I just never got into it. Mm-hmm. Like, but if anytime I did tune into it, always liked it. I've never watched an episode of Seinfeld to where at the end I didn't go, that was really good. Yeah. I just never went out of my way to watch it when it was on. And the only time I ever went out of my way to watch it was the finale, and that was a wrong thing to do because the finale was one of the worst finales
Which
of all time.
Which did you watch? Disagree, like, what have been your sitcoms?
Sitcoms were Friends, for sure, Cheers. Mm-hmm. Never big sitcom fan.
How I Met Your Mother?
Nah.
No. Three's Company.
I watched
that all. Yeah, yes,
loved it.
And when it's and when there are reruns on TV Land, I watch them every
time.
That was my first sitcom
that I really liked.
Same.
Because it wouldn't be on night when I'd watch it. I'd be watching it during the day on reruns. But
I love Lucy.
Yeah.
My first one was my Family Ties. Then Family I went Ties? To Cheers.
Yeah. Who we got? Who's this?
We're just opening the door to Ghost.
Oh, look at that!
Oh, all right. So hey, Perri has entered the building. Perry's entered the building.
But she entered with a face.
She did. She's just like, am I allowed to be here?
Yeah. Or, I wasn't sure if I was allowed to walk in. Just like
the answer was no, but you did it.
Alex. He told me to.
Perri, what are you drinking?
Listen, let me tell you something about Alex. Alex has been running around this place like his shit doesn't stink. And
leaving toilet seats up.
Yeah, he's really doing.
Excuse me?
Yeah, he left the toilet seat up. It's not a good thing.
That's not true, actually.
Lucky
we figured
I didn't
out
catch
he
that.
Didn't.
Could Riley just, you know, right in the middle of a bit, just piss all over.
That's my job, Riley. That's my job.
Can I come?
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, you can.
Perri's run into a bunch of jokes that she doesn't understand, so we're going to move on.
Yeah.
How are you doing?
I'm doing okay.
What's going on?
Nothing.
Nothing?
Had to make a quick pit stop at home, really.
Can you talk
really
about why? You don't want to.
Dewey's wearing a cone.
What's wrong with Dewey? Her cat is wearing a
cone. Don't make fun of it if I tell you what happened.
I'm not
going to
make
a joke about it.
Well, I'm not going
to
make fun
of it. Because it has to do with his anus.
What's he doing? Is he trying to sniff his own anus? What's he doing?
No. apparently, this is a common thing with dogs and not cats. One of his anal glands ruptured. So the poor thing is wearing a cone and he's on medication and everything.
Yeah. How did you find out the anal gland had ruptured?
I was actually on Monday morning just about to walk into this office, had like my bag on me and everything, about to walk out the door, and I noticed like two little droplets of blood on the floor, and I thought maybe I cut myself,
and then
I picked him up and I saw it and I rushed him right to emergency, and thankfully it's like a fairly routine thing. My heart breaks for him.
How old is Dewey?
He hates that cone. Yeah. He's going to be 7 in a couple of months.
He's 7. Because I said to her,
that's
she told
young for a cat.
It is.
You're still fine.
Well, she told me this morning, you know, about the thing, and I said, yeah, that is definitely a dog thing. But when you meet Dewey, because I'm not a big cat person, never have been a cat person, but I have met Dewey, and Dewey is like everybody always says, every cat owner, you know, my cat's just like a dog. My cat's just like a dog. No, not this cat. You don't even know. This cat's like a dog. No, your cat's not like a dog. This cat is actually like a dog.
Really?
I went over. We did that video of the cooking the eggs.
Video, yeah.
And the dog, I almost said, kept coming up and just like doing what dogs do. Wanted to be pet and that face.
What
of
kind
like,
of cat is it?
He's a Bengal.
My brother and his wife have a Bengal cat as well. He's kind of like a dog.
I do like this cat.
Super, super loving. Yeah. Every single day when I come home, he greets me at the door. He rolls over, all of that.
Does he ever get angry? Because a lot of cats get angry.
The only time he ever gets angry and the only time I've ever heard him hiss is when he goes to the vet for obvious reasons.
Because he's like, leave me the fuck alone.
Yeah, get out of my butt. Yeah.
Right. So
exactly that.
I get it. Nobody
sounds
likes
like
to go
a
to
bar
the
story from 2000.
How'd you guess?
Right. It was better than what? The guy spitting on you? Didn't the guy spit on you? He burped on you.
Farted on me.
Did you hear the story? Yeah. This guy that was hitting on her, she turned him down and he came back and literally farted on her.
Mm. Mm-hmm. And what did you do?
I laughed because what am I going to do?
But how do you hear it in the crowded bar is what I want to know.
No, he said it.
Oh, he said I just farted on you?
Yeah.
Oh.
Then he did it. He turned around. He lifted a leg. Maybe he had farted. It smelled, and he said he did it.
Maybe he had an anal gland problem.
And you didn't snap back?
I was with it. Okay. It's a longer story than this, but we had gone on a date months prior. It didn't move the needle for me.
Yeah.
He asked me out again. I said no.
You had a Nostradamus vision that this guy would fart on you eventually.
And then I was sitting at the bar with a new guy. And this guy sees me from across the bar again months later, and he comes over and he turns around and he said, "Eat my shit," and he farted on me.
It's a nice thing to say to someone.
And I was in such shock, kind of like the Hitler situation,
right.
Where I just kind of was like, "Huh."
Yeah. Huh. Ever have anyone fart on you, Perri?
Absolute. Well.
Well.
Oh God.
What a pause. Well,
absolutely.
Use more words.
I feel like she might be watching or something, but
well, in college this one time.
A certain someone in my family is the queen of farting.
This is your sister?
Yes, it is.
Awesome. Happy birthday to her, by the way.
Is that the sibling?
Yeah, she just so
Is that the sibling fight? Is that how you scratch a pole and she's rip one?
I'm like super neat and clean and organized right. And like she'll just fart That's anywhere, it. Anytime. And
do people who fart,
and
are
like
they not
she's a
clean?
Dog and she'll blame it on the dog. No, it has nothing to do with being clean. She just knows I don't
she knows
like
it. How to rip it.
Yeah, but you said I'm super clean and organized and she's a farter.
Right.
Like it's the opposite of being clean.
She's a farter and a drop crumbs on the floor, you know. They go hand in hand.
It's amazing. Well, there you go.
Oh, God.
There you go. Welcome to Quiet Alive, Perri.
So weird that we as a society picked that to be the gross one.
What, the farts?
Yeah.
It's unpleasant.
Well, it stinks.
But there's so many things that we do that are gross.
Yeah.
And that's the one. Like, I'm so envious of farters because you guys know I have a really bad, like, bowel issue and I can't go to the bathroom for 14 days at a time. I wish I could
that's
fart.
That's insane.
It would help. It sucks. And so when somebody farts.
I figure that would give someone a headache.
Yeah. Oh, I have a headache all the time.
You have
I have migraines. I black
right.
out.
It's your body saying, let it out.
But I sit there anytime somebody farts, and part of me is a little grossed out, but part of me is like, good for you.
Yeah.
Good for you.
Okay.
Like, I want that.
You needed that
in my
out.
Life. Right. Yeah.
It's like,
yeah.
It's like,
you
it's,
know, that's what bathrooms are for.
Just what are you
and leaving
to
the
do?
Toilet seat up, apparently, Alex.
What I hear from my friends, you can't control the fart a lot of the times. Like, you could just, it comes out.
Should we play the clip for Perri? And see if she can guess the 80s movie?
Yeah.
Probably not if it's an 80s
At this point,
movie.
She's going to know what it is.
No,
but we
it's a classic.
If it's a 90s
no,
movie,
it's
know
a movie
it.
We all talk about a lot.
Yeah. I'm going to. She was the only reason that I think that she might not know it is because she was in Sundance, but I'm going to go ahead and guess that she knows what it is the second she hears
We've been talking
it.
About a lot
I'm trying
recently.
To guess just based on that statement.
All right, ready?
Why would Sundance stop me from knowing it?
Here we go.
It's been a recent
Here
topic.
We go, Perri. This is from Cody. Which scene are you going to play?
I think the only one I haven't done yet is the post-credit scene.
The post-credit scene. Okay,
yeah,
okay. All right, here we go.
A Marvel movie.
When a goldfish can you? When a goldfish can you?
I know that's like your thing, but I don't know where that comes from.
Do I care? So everybody knows at this point.
Does this picture behind help you guess where it comes from?
Perri, you have to have probably seen some Twitter replies with that.
I don't really pay attention to them, if I'm being honest.
No. It is a Marvel movie in some respects.
True.
Shared universe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
An 80s movie.
An 80s Marvel in some respects.
I have no
movie.
Freaking clue.
All right, fine. Then how about actually, Cody, for real, I know you pulled some other clips from the movie. Can you actually play one of the other clips that you played?
Yeah, the actual movie.
Yes, yes.
The power of Sean Penn compels you.
I can already tell this probably isn't my thing.
All right.
It's not Josh McCook's thing either.
One more, please.
Okay.
It's a talking pregnancy test.
I have no clue.
All right, last one.
This is some 80s comedy that I don't know.
It's Tom Dagnino's show that is coming out on February 14th called Little Bobby and the Juice.
Okay. Yeah.
Have you not seen it?
How could you have not known that, Perri?
I don't feel that bad about not knowing something.
The full episode comes out on the 14th. Have you seen the full episode?
No, I have not.
Have you?
Yeah.
How could I? I said it comes out on the
14th. You said he was going to send it to you.
He did not. It's Finstock. Are you surprised?
But how are you going to know if you can play it on the show or not?
Well, I'm not going to play it on the show. I'm going to talk to him about it. And then if I watch it and I realize that it's something I don't want to ever promote ever again, then I won't ever promote it. I just like Carl.
His name's Carl.
Yeah. Carl the Carney.
Carl!
Carl! When it goldfish here.
Yeah.
Rest in peace, thank you,
Perri. Thanks for playing along.
Oh, of course.
But she loved it,
you can tell.
Yeah. We're gonna have Jay Baruchel.
I predicted that it was not for me.
You've seen How to Train Your Dragon 3.
Yes, I have.
And I hear great things.
Yeah.
And
Look out for the visuals in that movie. They were telling me about a new lighting technique that they're able to use, which makes certain qualities in the movie photoreal. And
you can feel it.
Wow.
Who's that? I can't believe that.
I did the junket and spoke to the director, and he kind of ran through, you know, a light version of what it is. I'm sure there's millions of pages out there explaining what that tech actually does.
I'm excited to talk to him about that. I can't wait to see this movie. I was a big fan. We got into a little bit of a discussion yesterday. I love the first movie. I like the second one better.
So I watched the second one last night, and I can see why some people like the second
more
one
layered.
Over the one. It is. There's a lot going on that's like, and I loved it even more than I thought I would, but I'm still a part one guy.
Yeah,
I just love it because of, you know, pretty obvious reasons of the boy and his dog kind of, you know, story.
I wonder if Jay's a part one or a part two kind of guy.
That's a good question to ask.
Yeah. Well, what's he going to say?
Yeah. One of the two.
He's not gonna give you a
He's gonna say he likes all of them.
Yeah. I think he'll give an answer.
You think so?
Yeah.
I bet you the answer is I've got of course the first one to me is where we found the character and all this, and the second one is really good. I don't know. I'm always gonna feel a little to the first time we've stepped into the character. He's not gonna give you a straight answer.
I think he'll say that he likes part three the best and you should go see it.
All right. We'll see. Maybe.
I would put my money on that.
All right. That's a good
one. Yeah.
That's be wicked smart.
I do want to take, because we're not doing phone calls at the 11:30 part of the show, because obviously Jay Baruchel's coming in. So we are going to take a couple phone calls now, if possible.
Whoa.
Cody. Yeah. See a couple calls and see what we can do. Yeah, why not? Is that okay with you, Cody?
Sure, why not?
Okay.
He's so excited about it. By the way, watching back yesterday.
Yeah.
Because I never get to see what those kids in the booth are doing.
They mess up. They mess around.
Oh, my God. Great. They're rocking out. They're pretending to fall asleep while we're talking.
Yeah.
They're doing all of the scams.
Here's the thing. Yeah, but here's the thing with that. Because Cody has earned it.
Yeah, Alex. I don't care what Cody is telling him. When Alex is pretending to sleep, I'm like, bitch.
See, this is the thing.
Put the seat down.
Cody has been getting shit from us since 2014.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a look of a scared puppy when Cody first started the show. Now it's like when you walk in, hey, Cody, yeah, what do you need? You don't think that's true? Okay, well, then I didn't want to argue with you. Should I go on and tell the rest of my story?
Yosh.
Thank you.
Yosh.
All right, so what I was saying here is Alex has been on this show for maybe 4 months or 5 months, whatever the hell. I don't know if he's earned it. I don't think he's been able to earn this, the sleeping.
You guys are so hard on him.
Yeah.
I love Alex, and I set him up for success in every kind of way, but you got to be careful when you come in somewhere and you're watching Cody do what he does and you think you can do that.
Because they'll slit your throat, the wangers.
I feel like this all comes from the toilet seat issue. And I'm way harsh with that rule. But, you know, you got to give someone a pass every now and then.
And the wangers will get rid of you in a heartbeat. Just ask the kid and ask the rest of them that just kind of came and went. It's just Beardo, Copster, and Cody. They don't care about anyone else. Is that true, Cody?
Yeah, we're ruthless.
See? Alex, can you explain your behavior?
I just kind of want to have fun. And I feel like I'm having fun with you guys. Fun doing this. It's all I can contribute.
You don't think it's a rebel against society?
No.
You don't think it's buck the system, we can't see you, so you're trying to stick it to the man?
Yeah, actually it is a little bit of that.
That's what I thought.
He does bring us food sometimes though, so.
He does. And he's
makes
you know that he talks very healthy. He eats very healthy because we during Schmoedown times we have the pizzas, we get a lot of the pizzas, and he goes, "Well, I can't just eat pizza." So he walks out and he goes get something else.
Cody feels the same way. Cody eats really healthy, can't just eat pizza.
Cody, you gonna start eating better now?
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah, you want to stick around.
Yeah, what are you going to serve your soon-to-be daughter?
It's not. Yes, yeah,
I'm just guessing.
That's the thing. I don't know how your wife is, Cody, but like my kids started young and they eat broccoli. They love broccoli. Like, wow. Most kids hate broccoli. Oh, my kids love broccoli because
I loved broccoli too. Yeah. My mom did it like really fun. Really lemon and olive oil, early, garlic.
Sprinkle a little cheese on there, and you don't like cheese, but for other
you
kids,
like cheese.
Oh yeah.
I hate cheese.
Yeah, she hates cheese.
I hate cheese. I hate cheese.
Yeah, she hates cheese.
Everybody asked me about it.
Yeah.
I hate cheese. All of it. And on everything. Pizza, mac and cheese.
So you pissed her off once by saying that. What was your number one movie last year?
Oh yeah.
Life Itself.
I was on the phone with she's gonna hate me because she's definitely watching this. I was on the phone with my mom the other day, and you know what she was watching?
Life Itself.
You know what she was loving? Life Itself.
Wow. Yes. And my best friend who lives in New York called me this week and was like, I heard you talking on a show about Life Itself and how much you liked it. And I saw it had a 13%. I'd give it a shot anyway. I was crying the whole time. It was amazing.
Yeah.
I was like, look at me planting these seeds.
Is it
look
at me. Is it one of these movies that critics hate and people who watch it love?
No.
It's not. What's the audience score?
I wish I could say that, but the audience score is still pretty low.
Is it? Cody, can you bring up the audience score for Life Itself?
I think the audience score is like a 50 or something.
It's still pretty high for that movie.
The cinema score, I feel like, was really low. Like, is it too extreme to say a D- on that?
No, oh, 78%, see?
Wow.
See?
Maybe.
Yeah, I told you.
4.2 out of 5.
And 964 people, as opposed to the 121 rotten. Yeah, so look at that.
18 fresh. That's crazy to me. And if you read the comments of the people who thought it was fresh, they're not particularly nice about it.
Yeah, I got to watch this stupid movie.
I love it.
6%
what is it, 6%?
Now. That's what it is now. That's at 6. What did it drop? Was it 12 originally?
No, I think it went to top critics instead of all
critics.
To be fair,
that's not very many reviews for a wide release on Rotten Tomatoes.
True. Well, no, there you go. I mean, it's over.
Top critics, 6%. That is a blast.
Oh, you were on top critics before.
Yeah.
That's different.
Yeah. So, Reilly.
We're ready.
For our interview?
Yeah, soon.
It's time.
Yeah, soon.
All right, listen. Okay, we're going to go to break. When we get back, we're going to talk to Jay Baruchel, who's here. Sorry, I guess the phone calls we got away from.
We'd love
to do it tomorrow. Mm-hmm. But Jay Baruchel's here. We're going to talk about How to Train Your Dragon, The Hidden World. And stick around and watch it. There. No, it's not late to the party. That's actually from Obi-Wan Kenobi. You didn't know that? Well, you should, and now you do. Jedi Council. What is it? It's about Star Wars, obviously. It's Jedi Council. Every week, the latest and greatest in Star Wars movie news, myself and Ken Knapsack, that's right, the pit boss himself, we have a guest on, and we talk about everything happening in the world of Star Wars. If it's the movie news, the TV news, canon news, comic books, games, and then we take questions from you guys on Facebook and Twitter. It's a lot of fun. We've been doing it for a couple of years now. I'm still excited talking about it. The fan base is coming together again. I believe it is. I think it is. I hope it is. And we're talking Star Wars, so we'd like you. That's right, all of you. If you're not a fan of Star Wars, come on over and join us every Thursday for Collider Jedi Council here on Collider Video. And we have an Apple Podcast feed or Podcast One, wherever you want to go if you listen to podcasts. And not only do you get Collider Jedi Council every week on Thursday, The Rule of Two with Mark Fernandez and Mark Reilly, that's on every week. I believe it drops on Wednesday. It's on one of these days. It's a good show. You should listen to it. I like it. I listen to it. I haven't listened to it once.
Okay. Hey, guys. Ryan Satin here from ProWrestlingSheet.com. And if you're a pro wrestling fan, which I hope you are, even if it's in secret, then you should be checking out Wrestling Sheet Radio Weekly. We've got a bunch of shows in the podcast feed. We've got weekly recaps from myself and John Rocha, which you guys will probably know from the Collider family. That's for Raw. That's for SmackDown. We've also got the weekly roundup of wrestling news. It's a show I host called Wrestling Sheet Radio with Jamie Iovine and Elijah Bates. And we've also got a bunch of other stuff in our YouTube channel, youtube.com/C/Wrestling Sheet. So check it out, subscribe, and I hope you guys dig it.
Hey, everyone. Mark Ellis here. You know, when I'm not trying to clone dinosaurs or drinking at my neighborhood watering hole, I am probably hosting Collider Movie Talk. It's a flagship show here at Collider. I like to say that because I'm the host of it. It's every day, almost. It's 4 days a week, which is still...
Hey, guys. We know this ad is a little outdated. Stand by. We're going to make a new one soon.
All right, back to this outdated
app. PM Los Angeles time is when we do it. It's live, so you can participate in the live chat room. Go ahead and give us your thoughts on every story we have coming, because it's all the latest movie news of the day. Who did what at the box office? What horrible Redbox movies Bruce Willis signed on to? The DC, the Marvel, the Star Warses, the Lord of the Rings. Are they making new? I think it's a TV show, and we still might talk about it anyway, because we love movies around here. It's myself and an expert panel of guests, including John Rocha, Perri Nemiroff, Jeff Snyder, and other noted noters of note. You guys are going to love this show, and then we take your live Twitter questions at the end of the show at Collider Video. You can always use the hashtag Collider Movie Talk to get in touch with us, so subscribe right here to Collider Video. Check out Movie Talk, and check out the Collider Movie Talk podcast feed. We have a podcast feed now. You don't have to look at this handsomeness. You can just listen to it, whether you're driving to work, whether you're driving from work, or you don't have a job, but you have a basement and ears. You can listen to Collider Movie Talk's feed. You can get it at Apple Podcast or on iTunes. You also get Mailbag. That's the show that's hosted by Perri Nemiroff a lot more professionally than I run this pirate ship. That's our weekend show where she takes your letters. I don't know if you write them or you email them. You have to ask her. Check it out in video form or on our podcast feed.
What's up, Collider fans? If you are a fan of television and you want to watch a guy that looks like me and a guy named Thad Williams talk about TV every single Friday, subscribe to the Collider channel. Collider Podcast is where you can find the video. We have our own iTunes feed, hashtag Collider TV Talk. You can find on iTunes or wherever you find your podcasts and you listen to them in your ear holes. That's where Collider TV Talk comes at you. We talk about TV news. We talk about shows we love, shows that we don't love. And most importantly, we don't read any books, because TV has nothing to do with reading. We also have a show called Hypothetical Questions with myself and Roxy Striar, and all kinds of reviews right here at the Collider Podcast channel and the Collider TV Talk feed. Subscribe, rate, like, tell your friends, tell all your friends to tell their friends, and before you know it, it's a pyramid scheme of television. I'm Josh Macuga. You can see Thad Williams and myself along with Roxy Striar and all the Collider personalities all the time right here on Collider TV Talk. As always, put down the book, pick up the remote.
Hey everyone, I'm Scott Movie Mance, and just to let you know, if you already don't, every Friday here on Collider Video, I host a weekly film review series called Movie Review Talk. The title says it all. Every week I'm joined by two guest critics of my choice, and they're never the same. We review the new films. We pick something that's streaming that you might not know about, but is really great. And we pick a Blu-ray for something that you might have missed in theaters. It is fun. It is infectious. It is the Citizen Kane of movie review shows. And it's only right here on Collider with this guy, Scott Movie Mance, Mr. Movie Release Dates himself. Check it out every Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific, only on Collider Video.
And we're back, Collider Live. It is Wednesday, and as promised, in studio from How to Train Your Dragon 3, The Hidden World, star of that film, Jay Baruchel. How are you, man?
I'm very well, thank you. How are you?
I'm good. It's a pleasure to have you in studio.
Thank you for having me.
You know, what's funny is we almost had you in studio for, we'll talk about it in a little bit, with Goon 2.
Oh, yeah.
Directing it.
Yeah.
We do a trivia show here.
Of course,
we talked
about
another thing too. But to finally get you in here now.
Very happy to be here.
Yeah, to talk about this movie. And right before we went on air, I dropped my daughter off at school.
Yeah.
She's 7 years old. And I said, you know, I'm going to get a chance to talk to Hiccup today. And she's like, what? And she's like, you have to tell him that I said hi. And I was like, I will.
I say hi back.
Kids love this movie. I love this movie.
Oh,
everybody in here loves this movie. Yeah.
That's awesome.
The first and second movie to me, and we had this discussion right before you got in. The second movie was so layered.
Yeah.
To me, and there's like a lot of things that happened. And I love the first one, but the second one to me is my favorite.
Yeah, right. It's a special flick.
We have a bet going on, and we're going to ask you this question.
Okay.
Not including the new one that comes out.
Yeah.
Out of the
Come on! Are you kidding me?
Nope.
That completely changes the bet.
Let me finish.
Okay.
Out of the first two, which one did you respond to the most? Out of the two.
Oh, of the number one and two?
Correct.
Yeah, probably the second one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you know how awesome you are that you just did that?
Yeah.
Because I thought you would have an answer, and I thought it would be the third one. He took the third one out of the running.
Yes. It obviously would be the third one.
Right. Go see the movie.
Correct. Well, yeah, not just that. I mean, I am here for a unofficial business.
Right.
So, yeah, don't bother going to spend money to see a new movie when you can watch the old one for free. I have no skin in this game whatsoever. Mercifully, it's not crap though. When I say that, I legitimately think this one is the best one. But yeah, they're all special.
They're really good movies, and they agreed. And especially when you do. Look, a lot of times you can put together franchises because they just make money.
Yeah, right.
But when you're part of something that is, it's special, and you know it's special.
Yeah, it's a different thing, especially because we always knew that even on the first one, we were working backwards from this ending. We knew that back in 07 or 08. Yeah, I did my first recording session in 07. A different director, is a whole different take on the movie. That as the original iteration of How to Train Your Dragon was not remotely similar to what came out in the world.
What was the difference?
Wow.
It was way sort of cartoonier, a bit more...
goofy?
Yeah, a bit goofier. Yeah. The characterizations were everything from the artwork to how we were told to play them was much closer to kind of... If you've seen what Hiccup looks like in the books. Yeah. Just a bit sort of... Yeah, a bit more fun, goofy. And when Dean DeBlois and Chris Sanders came in... Their big instinct was, no, this has to be Star Wars or Dune or Tolkien. It has to have a weight to it, and it has to have shadows, and it has to be about stuff, and there has to be loss, and we have to understand the cost of things, and they just everything that everyone loves about How to Train Your Dragon was brought to the franchise via Dean and Chris.
Wow.
And for me, it was literally just like. I went to an audition and went like, seven. And now here we are, and it's like this epic global phenomenon. Yeah. Pretty cool.
It's crazy to hear that, too, because if they had gone down that path, that cool lighting technique that I was telling you guys about probably wouldn't be a thing, where all of a sudden you've got, like, photoreal water and fire and stuff.
Ray tracing? Yeah. The technology has increased exponentially. Between each film, and I think each film necessitates the creation of new technology, right? It's a mother of invention. And so, you know, now I feel I have no place speaking to that because I literally just do what I'm doing here. I just talking to a microphone six times a year for 3 years, and then a movie comes out, and everyone's like, oh my God, what's it like? And there's like, I hate using terms like unsung heroes, but like, if the movies are special, it's because of the army of people at DreamWorks Animation who have toiled ceaselessly to bring this to life. And and I just get to go out and get all the applause for it. Yeah.
That was one of my questions for Dean the other day at the junket was, who is the unsung hero of this franchise? And it's a question that I put in my back pocket for all animation junkets because nobody ever talks about the thousands of names that you see at the very end of the movie.
Correct. And it's also it's an international project as well. They have animators in Argentina and all over the place. It doesn't just take a village, you know. It takes more than that, and it's a hell of a thing to be part of the gold standard in animation, you know.
Did you do the TV show also?
I did.
You did, right? Yeah. So I guess my daughter, I knew of the TV show because I believe, like I said, I heard your voice, and I'm watching.
Now only one person sounds as god awful.
Oh, stop it! But that show, because of the show and then the movies. But the question, because sometimes when actors do, whether it's some voice work, they don't always go to the junkets the premieres outside of the country and they're traveling around. Are you doing all those?
I've gone everywhere they've told me to go. I was there when we premiered number 2 at Cannes, which was like a pretty cool thing to stand on the top of that, you know, world famous stairway at the end of the movie. And, you know, I turned to Dean and I said, not bad for two boys from Quebec, eh? You know, this is pretty cool because, like, he's from Elmer, Quebec, small town near Ottawa. He's a Sheraton grad. And it's just kind of neat for us to have that. And so, I've gotten to see the world and to bring it places. And it's just like you can work your entire career and never be part of something that's like 1/10 as impactful as any of these movies, let alone all of them.
Do you think it's the most impactful film you've ever done or a franchise?
Oh, unquestionably. You know, there's ones that I like just as much, you know, but nothing I've been a part of has touched the globe like this has, you know. And also the kind of fandom that this particular Saga has is so avowed and sincere, and it's like, because and I suspect that comes from, if you think back to when you were a kid, how what your favorite stuff was when you were a kid, nothing in your adult life matches that. There's nothing you like as a grown-up as purely and all-consumingly as you did when you were little, right? And so I get to be a part of that for a whole bunch of, you know, and now the movies have been around for a decade, so yeah. There are teenagers getting ready to go to university to watching this one who were little kids when the first one came out, and that's like, I don't have the words to describe what that feels like. Yeah. It's really, really cool.
Well, that's the beauty of the trilogy, that especially from hearing you say before that you guys knew kind of the ending that you were leading up to in this film, and that's got to be so rewarding in general, because when the second one comes out and it's as successful as it was, it gets all the accolades that it does. Do you know at that point, well, I can't wait to do the third?
Yeah, but I also, I always, 100%, but I take nothing for granted. And I don't know if that's just like me having grown up poor and Canadian, but I just assume I never count my chickens. And a lot of things happen. There's no accounting for taste, right? And so there's plenty of things that I thought were amazing that I was a part of that the world didn't agree with me. Yeah. So I take nothing for granted, but I always knew that best case scenario we'd land where we landed.
Yeah. Riley, did you?
Oh, God. I don't even know where to start.
So Riley, let's just give you a background. Riley is a hardcore diehard fan of the franchise.
Oh, amazing.
Like the franchise.
You should have worn your shirt today. That's one of my favorite shirts.
Yeah, so I have a Batman shirt, but it's toothless.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
In the thing. I should have,
but instead you just dressed like a nice gentleman.
He's going to teach a class at the end of this.
But it's the, it's the first movie that really got me, and I'm an adult, and I was really sparking to you, like, when you talk about, like, how it touches kids. Yeah. You have no idea how important the first movie is to me because of, like, the what it meant at the time when I saw it.
Yeah.
I just revisited it because I'm not going to try to be sad here. I lost my dog.
Yeah, right.
This movie was so helpful.
Oh, good. I'm glad.
It just, like, it brought smile to my face, and when my fiance and I were watching, and I'm like, I feel better now.
Yeah, no, 100%. I think that's that. I'm very happy to hear that, and that's not an uncommon reaction.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of projecting of people's most beloved pets onto Toothless and all the dragons, you know. And so I think that's another thing that makes it rise above the din is anybody with a good heart cares for animals.
Yeah. Well, that's a good – so my fiance and I were watching this, and we of course, love Toothless, but we're like, there's some dog things. Yeah. There's some cat things.
Yeah,
was that, like, completely on purpose?
Yeah, I think and everybody is convinced their pet is the one that Toothless was based
right.
on, whether that makes sense or not. There's people like, I know you based Toothless on my Lhasa app, so I was like, well, nobody knows that dog exists. So, so that's probably not true, but I'm glad. That's how you're supposed to feel.
Right.
Dean says Toothless is equal parts dog and cat.
That's what I
see. In terms of behavior, yeah.
Well, here's another thing that you guys share love to, at least Riley and Perri, is that you're a big horror fan.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Big horror guy.
Big
because,
time.
And that leads into the movie you directed too. Because we directed, your first one was Goon 2.
Yes, it was.
Which, by the way, from the first movie, that movie, the first movie when it came out, I didn't know what to expect.
Yeah,
from that
right.
film. Because that was one of those movies, I didn't know if it was just going to be a slapstick comedy.
Yeah, right.
But very similar to what you were talking about with how the first How to Train Your Dragon shifted.
Yeah.
It shifted my expectations of that movie when I found it had heart.
Awesome.
And then the second one just carried that over.
Thank you.
And you did the same thing with that.
Thank you.
But let's talk about, but you have your Random Acts of Violence movie that you directed. Tell me your love of horror, how it led for you to do this second movie.
Yeah. Thanks for asking.
Yeah.
I suspect I have always had a kind of a pure love of horror and scary stuff. And I don't know quite that I can put my finger on when it started, but I always knew that, like, in my house, the second biggest day of the year was always Halloween. It was Christmas and Halloween.
Look at the smile on Perri.
And that's all from my mother.
Yeah.
And I had very cool parents who educated me on cinema and would, like, always do a 101 before whatever movie they show. So when they would show me, like, Road Warrior, before they play it, Mom would explain to me why this is special, what it means to her, why this is better than other movies, all these different things. And so I was...
What a cool mom.
Very, very, very. Yeah. And she was, like, such a hard SF fan. Like, all she read was Silverberg and Asimov and Arthur C. Clarke. That's, like, you know... And so I was versed in this stuff. And then in high school is when I really full on blossomed into all of it. I was reading Tom Savini books, and I had Fangoria every issue in my knapsack that year, throughout all of high school, I should say. And I think that I've tried to ask myself why, because it's like my two great loves in movies are horror and action movies. And I think it's the same reason I like heavy music, which is that it's pure and direct. It bypasses your intellect and goes right to your heart, and it gets no love from critics. And the fans are incredibly religious, right? Like, I'll put a Slayer fan up against a Maroon 5 fan any day, right? Like,
sorry, Cody, you're going to have to leave.
And I think horror and action is the same kind of thing. And so Random Acts of Violence, Jesse, my writing partner, and I have been trying, we've been trying for 7 years to get this movie made. Wow. 7 years ago, we wrote the first draft of the first treatment. So we had gone through God knows how many drafts of that script before Goon 2 was like, we were developing this way before Goon 2.
Right.
We always wanted to continue Goon, but this was the thing. And so we finally got to make it last summer back home in Ontario, Jordana Brewster and Jesse Williams from Grey's Anatomy.
Oh, I love him.
Yeah, a lot of women do. it's a very ugly cast I have. I'm there to cut the edge off, to take the edge off it, I guess. Photographed by Kareem Hussein, a really amazing cinematographer who shot Hobo with a Shotgun, in addition to a whole bunch of other amazing movies. And we shot it in 20 days this summer. And it's harsh as fuck.
Yeah, that's great.
What subgenre of horror would you put it in? Because now I'm picturing like a little bit of a Hobo with a Shotgun flare, and
so
that kind of excites
it
me.
It definitely, that color palette is evident in parts of our movie. I see, it's tricky. How I describe it to people I trust and how I describe it to my producers are two different things. So, I hate using terms like this, but I guess elevated horror. So it's basically, it's about this dude that writes very graphically violent horror comic book. Who's trying to come up with an ending. He wants to end the book. We're driving down from Toronto to New York for Comic-Con, and we have a few signings and stuff to do on the way. And on our journey, we start seeing people getting killed in a fashion very similar to the way his killer kills people in the comics. So it's apparent that there's some crazy person kind of riffing with us. And we set ourselves some pretty lofty goals, which is to sort of take the piss out of torture porn, take the piss out of devaluing female life. And, our whole film is built on a kind of question, which is how come we can all name Ted Bundy and John Wayne Gacy and Jack the Ripper, but most people can't name the people they killed? And how come we can all name Jason and Freddy, but can't name the horny kids that they kill in those movies, right? So, you know, Friday the 13th doesn't have these movies don't have leads. The killers are the leads,
right,
really. So if you agree that the killers are the leads, then what you're experiencing as a fan is vicarious sadism. And I think that that's kind of fucked. And so we approached our gore, especially coming off of Goon 2, which was very sort of deliberately operatic and over the top and peckinpah. We tried to make our violence incredibly clumsy and weird and offbeat and painful and awkward. I don't want anybody watching my movie and when someone gets killed, high-five the guy next to him, go, holy fuck, that's crazy, man. Because that shit, as entertaining as it can be, even if you don't agree with my bleeding heart stuff, it's just not scary. And I think that a horror film, if it fails to scare you or make you uncomfortable, it hasn't done its really sole job. And so to me, scary is clumsy and weird and unconventional. And so we have far less blood in this movie, but the violence is way harsher.
Scary in the moment, but also scary that you take home with you. Like, you're
ideally
stuck with this idea ingrained.
Ideally, like, there's a moment in this movie. It's the first time I've told anybody because it's like a moment that keeps, that really kills. People really like it. But we have a killer who you get to see do something you don't really see a killer do in these movies, which is psych himself up to kill a bunch of people. So you see him sort of beating his nerves. And I said, you know, just play it like you're going out to play a shift of hockey and everyone's watching. And so he's second guessing himself and starts stopping. And then he has to mash his head and starts hitting the hood of his car. And he fucking has to get his energy going. And then he goes in and just goes to town on them. And it's this sort of weird, real moment that sets up the violence to come. And the kind of cumulative effect of all of it is hopefully very disquieting.
What you described as kind of fucked is actually in almost every major horror movie from Friday the 13th to Halloween. Does that mean that you're not a fan of those films?
No, I enjoy them, and I enjoy some. I there's not many Jasons that I like. I like more of the there's Freddy's I like more than I like Jason's.
Did you like the Halloween remake?
Yeah, I think it's really good. I don't love that it's like. I don't like its apology for gun nut culture, which it ended up kind of being. So that kind of rubbed me the wrong way. And I don't know that they intended to do that.
It's the way that you interpreted it.
Yeah, but it ends up having politics in it, whether you want to or not. Everything does. And so I always, like, for me, it's Cronenberg and Clive Barker. And nobody can accuse any of those movies of being irresponsible, I don't think.
Well, you know, the thing is, hearing you talk about this, obviously, I mean, the amount of passion just came out of that speech right there, too. You can feel it, and it makes – I'm not the biggest horror guy, but I'm very interested in seeing your film from just the description of it. But I also – I like The Last Halloween, and I like what James Wan does with The Conjuring. I like movies when they make me think, or I have just a new spin.
Yeah,
it's just not the same shit over and over again.
100%.
But the question I have for you, though, too, is because you're obviously very passionate about acting. But with Goon 2 and now with this film, directing also seems to be something that you've wanted to do for a very long time, and now you're in the thick of it.
Yeah, luckily.
You can only choose one.
Yeah,
you're only allowed to do acting for the rest of your life or directing.
Oh, what directing. Do you take? Directing. That's
it. You're done.
I was 9 years old when I said to my parents, I want to write and direct horror movies and action movies when I grow up. My first day on set as an actor, I was 12. And so that was 3 years after that. And when I started at 12, Mom said to me, you want to go to film school. I think you being on set is probably the best film school in the world. And so and please don't infer anything less than pride and gratitude in the career I've had, because I am less than 20% of actors can feed themselves through acting. And I've been able to do it since I'm 12. So I am very, very proud. And I've got to do awesome stuff. However, it was never my raison d'etre. Like, always, it was – I was in acting to be a part of movies, not the other way around.
Right.
And so something I'm really happy about is, like, I'm getting to actually do this stuff. Now, after Goon 2, I don't assume I'll ever make a movie again. I want to. I have a whole bunch of movies I want to make, but every movie's a miracle.
Right.
And they're very hard to make. It's a prohibitively expensive art form, right? When the lowest, cheapest, shittiest, just four people in a room thing costs $1 million of somebody's money.
Right.
It's more expensive than a record. It's more expensive than a painting. You know, the cost of production is just prohibitive. So I take nothing for granted. But if I'm able to keep making movies, I'll make them so long as someone allows me to.
As a massive action fan, who do you want to direct? Which action star do you want to direct the most?
Oh, God. That's a really cool one. That's a great question. Well, I'd have to say, growing up, the biggies for me were obviously Schwarzenegger, Van Damme, and God help me, he's not my answer, but I have to say I was a fan of Steven Seagal when I was a kid before he became a Serbian citizen and lost his mind and started wearing fucking shooting range glasses and Soviet-style military parades, but and just looking like Dracula all the time. But really, my single favorite performance in any movie is Val Kilmer as Doc Holliday in Tombstone.
Oh, yeah.
So that would be it for me.
It's Val Kilmer. We've been talking about it at length here with Van Damme. We had him in last week.
That's so cool.
Cody, go ahead and play.
You want some cookies? I said, yeah. You want a glass of milk? I said, yeah.
He was telling the story about Bloodsport.
On the picture right behind you.
Yes, right behind you. Yeah. He was telling this story about Bloodsport, and he told this story about the guy that gave him the road, and he said, Van Damme, you will not be a star. You want cookies? I said, yes. And milk? I said, yes. And he told this whole story about how he got
it. You have a green card?
But yeah, I said, of course I do. I did not have my green card. But he's just so intense.
Yeah,
and he's
no
just
kidding.
But he's one of those things. It was amazing to see. But you hear of all these things. But the one thing that you said throughout this whole thing, a couple things I picked up was your mom.
Yeah.
Where did your mom's love of film come from, and like just going out and seeing movies as a kid, and then to just kind of teaching you that? Like,
yeah, I think it came from, so she was six of eight kids in a big kind of Irish Catholic family, grew up in an army base because my granddad was a soldier. She grew up in a world of pure necessity, basically. And she was this kind of unattended to little bright light in her family who adored Star Trek and adored all these things. And she was always told that stuff's silly.
Yeah.
And then she moved out of the house at 17. And that didn't dim her interest in horror and science fiction. It just, like, she now didn't have anyone to give her shit.
Right.
And so I suspect that I know, because, like, when I was growing up, she would tell me, nobody told me that I could do this. Nobody encouraged me. I had these ideas, and everyone told me this was silly. And what's a girl writing about spaceships in 1960 going to do for a living, you know? So as a result, Mom really kind of encouraged me always. You know, we were poor, but she said, you know, no matter what, we're never too poor for books. So you'll always have books. I read at a very, very early age. And then my father, also a very, very gifted, talented writer who never got to do anything with it, because he, I'll be perfectly frank. Yeah, he before I was born, he was a drug dealer, and then he went to prison, and then he started just selling microchips. That's what he did when I was a kid. Was just selling microchips, but he could sell anything to anybody, and a great lover of books and movies. And so every Friday and Saturday, Dad would rent at least two movies. The next morning, I'd wake up, and if the tape was in the machine, it meant I was allowed to watch it.
Awesome.
Because it was usually rewound, waiting for me. If it was back in this case, it meant it was like, you know, Wild Orchid or something that I wasn't supposed
not
to
yet,
see.
Not yet, kid.
Supposed to see. Yeah. But what this meant was every weekend for most of my childhood, I watched a minimum of two to four movies all the time. And my dad, to his credit, he wanted nothing more than for me to, like, live his life, sans the drug dealing, but he wanted me to, like, play hockey and just do everything he did, and that just wasn't going to happen. To his credit, though, when he saw that I had an interest, he supported it in a big way. He just wanted me to care about something.
Isn't that the most important thing?
Yes.
Because you have two parents here to support you, who basically fed you movies.
Yeah, correct.
And you would probably say, correct me if I'm wrong, that they are responsible for what you're doing
Dad bought me my first movie, and I have been collecting movies since that day.
What was the movie?
Ferris Bueller's Day Off on VHS,
that's
and it's
amazing.
Still number one for me. That started, so when I was a kid, everyone else was collecting, like, hockey cards. I did that a little, but really I collected movies. And my parents bought me books on movies. So, you know, you get those compendium of Roger Ebert reviews. So I just, like, read that cover to cover when I was nine, having never seen any of these films, right? Or even stuff just like, remember at video stores, they used to have those, like, once a year kind of catalogs to guides to what's out there. So Dad would just give the guy $20 at the video store to get that. And there's no critiques. It's literally just synopsis. It's just pages and pages of synopsis. I would just commit them all to memory. So I'd commit all these stories and all these directors. And I just, like, that was my life, right?
Well, listen, there's a couple things that I'm thinking, and I know the fans are know it. Yes, I absolutely am thinking, why hasn't Jay Baruchel played Sam Levine in a movie, Trivia Schmoedown? I'm absolutely thinking that. Guys, first of all, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
The movie is How to Train Your Dragon, The Hidden World, and it comes out on February 22nd. Mm-hmm. Thank you. I cannot wait. I know that everybody else here is Perri. You've been lucky enough to see it already.
I love this franchise. Yeah. That goes without saying.
Yeah. So
very happy to hear that.
Yeah, please come back and see us.
Thank you.
Especially
I'd love
to. Your movie when it hits.
Done.
We want to see it.
Done and
Jay
done.
Jay Baruchel, you're on Twitter, right?
I am indeed.
All right, so
not on Instagram though.
I am.
Now you are.
I just made a purposely inconvenient name as possible because. is so I have a real love-hate thing with social media, as I'm sure most people do. So I made my full fucking birth certificate name. So Jonathan Adam Saunders Baruchel at that's me on Instagram.
Amazing. Well, thanks again for joining us. We look forward to seeing all your stuff. And guys, thank you for joining us for today's show. Tomorrow we'll be back. Yes, Bobby Finstock and Citizen will be in to talk about Little Bobby and the Juice. And we will talk to you next time.